are the Orcs, and we have a plan.
To watch all of Ron Moore's Battlestar Galactica.
And drink beer.
Hello, friend, and welcome to Borgcast Galactica 6.7 with Peter and Anne-Marie. Hello.
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 We start this time with some trigger warnings and some context. Trigger warning one. Tonight's first full episode contains, well, let's face it, a fairly shocking suicide. Having just checked out the episode on BBC iPlayer, there is a tiny warning down the bottom that the episode contains disturbing scenes, which
it's not honest, enough.
Doesn't really cut it, does it? Yes,
no.
Considering that disturbing scenes are BSG's bread and butter generally anyway.
Yeah.
And had I remembered what happened in the episode, I would have flagged up a trigger warning in the last episode. But unfortunately, one of the nice things about coming to season four relatively fresh is the fact that I can't remember what happens next. The downside is, can't warn you about what happens next.
No.
So, sorry about that. Trigger warning two. Things progress over the two episodes into the planning of an armed revolt against the government. Now, clearly, such a thing could never happen in a healthy democracy. But I think we realise that most of us are living in democracies over which the Grim Reaper is rubbing his bony hands in glee at the moment. So you may feel you want to hold off listening to tonight's discussions until things feel safer and more stable. Please say those times will return. But the beauty of podcasts is you can listen to them whenever. So
yeah.
If you can't face it, we quite understand. And yeah, you can listen to it as and when you feel ready to.
Yeah.
Most of tonight's feedback, of course, will be recorded before the latest episode of Chaos and Evil caused by that man.
Yep.
So some of it may come across as a bit odd as a result, not picking up on those parallels, but that's clearly not the fault of our feedbackers, but the fault of events across the Atlantic.
Yeah. And I think it's also fair to say as well that it may be that either the combination of these two episodes together or any one of them means that you think, you know what, I'm not sure I can listen to this. And as somebody who's had that experience listening to a podcast where they flagged something up and I thought, you know what, I can't face into this. I'm not being funny, but it's okay to miss an episode.
Oh, yeah.
We don't mind if actually you never listen to this, if it's not something that's going to make you happy. Because we do a rather silly podcast with random tunes and shit in it and a lot of drunken swearing. And it's designed to make you happy. So if you don't want to listen to stuff that isn't going to make you happy, skip it. We don't mind.
I mean, I think it's fair to say, had we known in advance, before setting out on this journey with BSG, what was going to be happening in the world over the past 18 months.
We would be covering something else.
We would, yes, be doing Last of the Summer Wine or something.
I don't know what the fuck it is with you and Last of the Summer Wine.
I really want to do a podcast.
Fine. Find another old man and do it.
Well, yeah. Another old man into podcasting. There aren't very many of those.
No. We would never have gone with Last of the Summer Wine, or Allo Allo, for that matter, just to get that out there. But science fiction that's cheesy shit, yeah, quite probably.
And we do have some of that lined up for the future. So.
We do. So, you know.
Anyway. Before we get on to the two main events, there is the little issue of the confusion that arose from this face of the enemy thing, which initially I thought I'd just left behind on a previous spreadsheet that I'd used from the days when we were doing Next Generation.
Yeah, because we talked about it being a Next Gen episode.
Yes, but it turns out face of the enemy is a thing. It's just another load of minisodes halfway through the season because there was the big long break.
Oh, so they did some more... okay.
I'm not going to spend long on this because unfortunately... A, they're not on the DVDs or Blu-rays. And B, unlike previous sets of minisodes, not all of them are on YouTube. Parts 1 to 9 of the 10 parts are.
Oh, how bloody annoying.
I know. Yeah, I was sat there watching
you
it.
You could do 2 to 10, couldn't you? You could cope, couldn't
exactly.
you, if it was just the first one.
But
or,
no.
I don't know, 2 to 5 and 7 to 10. But not the last bloody one.
But as it turns out, I mean, I read the synopsis for the last part, and you're not missing an awful lot. It's set between Sometimes and Disquiet. It features Felix stuck on a lost raptor with an 18U on New Caprica, where they had a relationship. He thought they were working together to free prisoners, but she was actually killing a lot of them, for reasons that aren't adequately explained, to be honest.
Okay.
It ties into that scene with Felix and Baltar, where the former president whispers something incriminating, and that's when... Felix stabs him in the neck with a pen. Well, this is what he whispered about. The crew and other passengers on the Raptor end up getting bumped off by this eight, who's doing so to open Felix's eyes about something, but I'd say it's not massively clear. And then Gator ends up stabbing her in the neck and then tries to kill himself by ODing with a load of morphine.
So yet more suicide.
Yeah, attempted suicide in this case because he doesn't succeed. Because Hoshi turns up. You know Hoshi?
Yeah, well, from the most recent one.
Who apparently has a thing with Felix. I don't know if this is ever going to feature in the main series. It's a bit of a weird thing. I mean, it would have been nice to have done it. They actually kiss at one point.
Oh, yes, it would have been.
Yeah. But anyway, Hoshi manages to find him and Felix says there'll be a reckoning, which obviously then feeds into the second episode specifically. So it gives it some background to his distrust of the Cylons, but to be honest, we already knew that he wasn't particularly happy with them.
Yeah.
It gives some more angle on Number 8's untrustworthiness, but again, we knew that as well. So to be honest, it's even more incidental than the new Caprica stuff was, so we're not missing anything.
Fair enough.
So let's move on to Sometimes a Great Notion.
Yes, which is a stupid episode title.
Well, it comes from a 1960s novel by US author Ken Kesey.
Okay.
Who is the same guy who wrote One Flew Over a Cuckoo's Nest, which you will have heard of.
Okay.
And he's quoting a blues song, Goodnight Irene.
Sometimes I live in the country. Sometimes I live in town. Sometimes I take a fool notion to jump in the river and drown. Irene, good night. Irene, good night. Good night, Irene, good night.
Nice.
Yeah, it won't be a play.
So you said goodnight, Irene, and my brain went,
come on, Irene. Oh, I swear, at this moment.
So I said one thing and you thought a completely different thing that vaguely rhymed.
Yes.
Yeah,
that is exactly what my brain did. And then I was about to sing it and go, we should have that. And I went, no, it's not remotely related, is it?
Nope.
Shit. I'm not drunk enough to think I'm right. Clearly I need to drink more beer. Anyway, I do have tunes suggested that do actually fit for some reason later on, more than once.
250 skeletons so far from four different sites on the planet using our protocols.
The results are conclusive.
What's your point? They're not human. They're Cylon.
All of them.
All of them.
The 13th tribe was Cylon.
So, I'm mentioning this just because I've realised what it is about the previously on that's pissing me off.
Oh, here we go again with the previously on.
No. I've realised what's pissing me off about it.
Yeah.
So, I kind of expect previously on to be like the previous episode.
No.
Possibly a couple back. Right? But not massively. But what this one does is includes the prophecy of Pythia and Lee and Dee to kind of go, this is the content we will show you in this episode. And I fucking hate spoilers for what I'm about to watch.
Mm.
So, I mean, already I have to get up and do something else or play games on my phone while they do the whole drum beat, show you all the shit that the stuff you're going to see in the episode and ruin it for you. And now I can't even watch the fucking previously on because it gives me a hint of what I'm going to watch. No, fuck off. Stop it.
Yeah, well, at this point, they're pointless because they exist in order to bring people up to speed, but we've had four seasons.
I know!
There's no hope now. If you're not watching it in order, why the hell are you watching the last half of the fourth season?
Exactly! So it just makes you know what, you know, oh, there's going to be stuff about Lee and Dee in this episode, and the prophecy of Pythia is going to come up again, and how, when you think to more recent episodes, how Rosalind did/didn't fit it, given what they found on Earth. And it's just like, you just told me half of what you're telling me in the episode. Stop it, don't do it!
Well, that said, it doesn't really prepare you for what's going to happen later on anyway.
No! So I wouldn't mind previously on, given that there had been a season break, that was a bit of a recap of the episode immediately before.
Mm-hmm.
That would be absolutely fine in context. Previously on, with stuff from fucking way back, is just showing your hand, you see? Just no! Go and play some fucking poker screenwriters and learn about not showing your hand. Bloody hell. Sorry. Made me cross. And then you've got a scene of Saul at the beach, and my brain immediately went, ah, Tigh and Tide wait for no man.
Ooh, that was an episode title that thankfully they didn't go for.
Do you like my pun?
No.
Oh, okay then. So there's various people by the sea, and I'm just going to do all of this at once because it's just, I can't be fucking asked. Right.
That's pretty much all we need to say, to be honest.
They're all by the sea. Rosalind finds a thistle, which later on in the episode she clings to. And at various points, the Cylons, the final three, four?
Oh, four down there. Yeah.
All four. When they touch things, they remember stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So you get a scene, the first one is Tyrrell, touches a wall, and you get a busy street, and he's got glasses on. And then you have Anders touches a bit of a guitar, and it turns out he's the one who was playing.
He's Jimi Hendrix, somehow. I mean, he's a bit white for it, but apparently he's Jimi Hendrix in this universe.
Yeah. Well, no, not necessarily he was playing it, so he could have just been...
No, apparently that was the intention, was that he wrote the tune. Yeah.
Whitewashing much.
Indeed.
And then Tori appears, and because she's a Tory and therefore useless, she doesn't actually have anything to offer.
No, she doesn't get any flashback beyond the saying, oh yeah, I was there.
Yeah.
It's like, well,
she's a Tory. What does she have? Nothing. And then right at the very end, you have a scene with Tigh, which I'll come back to.
Mm.
So then some bloke who I have never seen before, but you're probably going to tell me I've missed, is testing the water and stuff. And he's got glasses on, and then he gets...
No, he's not a thing.
Okay, fine.
As far as I know, anyway.
And basically, there's low-level radiation in the plants and in the water, so you can't eat or drink anything on that planet. And it was nuked 2,000 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So even though it was a flourishing city and they had electric guitars.
Yeah.
Right. And then Dee is digging on the beach, and she finds Jax and gets very upset by it. I think...
Because it's a children's toy, I'm assuming.
Yeah, I think so. It's because it's a child's game. And then Rosalind and the others who've been down to the planet, there's a crowd waiting for them when they return. But Rosalind can't cope and just says, get me out of here. So they're ushered off. And then you've got Hilo shouting, you know, you'll be told everything. On the one hand, I can understand that she is not psychologically prepared to deliver bad news and just wants to go. But one of the things that is a theme of her ever since this moment is dereliction of duty.
Mm-hmm.
She might feel bad, not like saying anything, but she's the fucking president.
Mm.
And even if she can't say anything now, at the very least, she should say something like, and it should be her saying this, I will give a press conference.
Yeah.
You know, so if she, I get that not, you know, she's still a human being. She can't cope speaking now. That's the, you know, telling them now, that's fine. But at the very least, it's her duty to say, I'm going to give a press conference in, you know, give a time, a couple of hours in the future, so she's got time to prepare, and everybody will be told things then at the same time. But to just do nothing and say, get me out of here, is dereliction of duty. And then you've got Kara searching for the colonial locator, and when she finds it, Leoben finds a wing that says 757NC, and Kara's Viper is 8757NC, so she starts doing her nutting. And then you've got Halo and Athena are playing with Hera, and Dee comes to babysit. And she says, oh no, you know, I really like babysitting. And she says, you've got no idea what's going on, do you? It's just a normal day. And then you come on to the bit that you mentioned, that the Cylons are digging up skeletons and centurions, except they're old centurions. They didn't look to me like the normal centurions.
No, I mean, obviously they shouldn't be, because they're not... I don't understand the chronology here, I must be. I got very confused. Why would the 13th tribe Cylons look like the others? Because they do look vaguely like them. You know, considering they parted company thousands of years ago, it doesn't make any sense. Now, on the commentary, Ronald D. Moore says the creation of the Cylons is meant to have dated back to the days of Kobol. But that's not the impression I'd got up until now. And it isn't borne out in Caprica, the later series, from what I remember of it. So I think they've got this wrong, personally. But there you go.
Well, see, I've not seen Caprica. Because you were watching...
It's all about the development of the first Cylons. And it's kind of just a generation back. It's Adama's father.
Yeah.
So it's not that long ago that Cylons were invented, but the 13th colony have got them. I mean, you could argue, well, it's like parallel evolution.
Yeah.
But why would they then look so similar? That doesn't make any
sense.
Well,
that, I think, ties in with the whole we'll be reborn thing.
There's no reason why they would look the same, though.
Well, possibly if they don't.
I mean, you can see the whole idea of the series, the same events happen again and again. But again, they wouldn't look the same, though.
Well, there is the question of whether they do actually look the same, or whether because they're the same Cylon reborn, as it were, they are placing themselves in the picture.
The Cylon head they dig out is not exactly the same, but it's much the same as a classic Cylon look.
Yeah.
Why would that be similar? I don't understand. Anyway, it's a little thing. Move on.
So they automatically thought when they excavated these sort of centurions and skeletons was that it was parallel evolution, and these were humans, and they created their own Cylons, and their own Cylons rebel against them and nuke the planet. But it turns out, no, the skeletons are of Cylons too.
Mm-hmm.
And the 13th tribe were Cylons.
Again, makes no sense, because the humanoid Cylons have only been evolved very recently since the last Cylon War, so it doesn't make any sense. But anyway, because this is thousands of years ago this happened, and they died. Oh, anyway. It doesn't make any sense.
Again, I've got a theory about that. The fact I've got a theory about it doesn't mean it's any good, but we'll discuss it when we get towards the end, and I tell you what I think, and then you can be like, either, oh yeah, that's a good point, or nah, that's bollocks. So, as a result of the president dereliction of duty, Adama tells Lee to carry the ball. But he's got, as Zarek then later points out, I think it's in your episode, what authority has he got to do anything? Because he's not the acting president anymore, and he's not the vice president, he's not the anything, is he? So how can he carry the ball, as it were, anyway? And then Saul says to Adama, we need to talk. And then you've got Lee doesn't know what to tell the quorum, and he's talking to Dee. And again, you've got, again, he's now a member of the quorum, and he's a civilian person, yet here he is in the, what is it, the pilot's briefing room.
Yeah, just he's like wandering around the battle star again. Yeah.
And there's a clear chemistry still between him and Dee, and he asks her to join him for an evening drink. And then you have the quite gruesome scene where Starbuck finds her body in a Viper. And you can see
Orchard, the uniform Orchard, is just a skull.
And hair.
Hair untouched. Hair. Not even blackened, it's bright blonde. It's like, hang on.
It doesn't work like that. I have caught
She got
hair.
Flameproof hair or something.
Yeah, it's like, no, it doesn't. It's like, I've caught my hair on fire in a candle before now. Quite close to my skin. Hair gone. And I'm like patting it out desperately.
They didn't have to do that. They didn't have to put the silly wig on it.
No, because
she
the
takes the dog
tags.
Tag, you know.
It's like, what? They just know. That isn't how hair works. I mean, the only thing I can think is that sometimes when you dig up a body that's been buried, so not a Viper that's crashed and caught fire, okay, but a body that's been buried, of somebody who's died of natural causes, you do sometimes find some hair on the body. And so I'm guessing that that's what they're using as their frame of reference. They've gone, oh yeah, well, when you dig up bodies, you know, for archaeology, sometimes you do find that there's hair on them. Well, yeah, you do. But they're not bodies that are fucking caught fire. That's not how fire works. Yeah, sorry. It's just, presumably you found the same, that it was really took you out of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But yes, the dog tags are hers, and so she doesn't know who she is. But I mean, she didn't know who she was anyway.
No. But it's cast even more of a mystery on it now.
What I find interesting, and I hope gets explored, is that at some point Leoben says, that's not what I thought, and he steps
he's
back.
He's completely lost now.
He is, yes. Yeah, so yeah. Up until now, he's been really certain about absolutely everything, and now he hasn't got a bloody clue. And
yep.
I hope they follow that up because it's interesting, because it's a change for him. So yeah. I hope they follow it up. And then you have Roslyn burning the scriptures. And I'm surprised Adama doesn't come in and just slap her in the face and put it out, because he loves books and she's burning a fucking book. I don't care what the book says, you don't burn it. Anyway, she's burning the Pythian prophecy because of all the damage it's done. And then she isn't going to show up for her treatment. And she says that all the people who listen to her are dead. And I can understand where she's coming from, that she thought that she was leading people to a new home and to hope, and she's led them to a wasteland.
That's going to knock you in.
So, you know, I'm not saying I have no sympathy for her. And I completely understand why that makes her stop her treatment. You know, that it's she feels depressed, and it's kind of like an act of self-harm, if that makes sense, that she stopped having treatment for the cancer. But I'm not being funny, but what is burning the book going to achieve? Is she finding it cathartic, do you think? Because it's still there. It's not like it's the only copy.
Yeah. Don't know. Not in her right mind, is she?
No, she isn't. And then she asks Adama to leave. And then you have Kara building a funeral pyre for herself, which must be a bloody odd experience.
Yeah. Look, it's really well shot there.
It is,
nighttime footage. Very well lit.
I'm afraid, though, it made me think of The Phantom Menace.
Yeah, that's the only thing when you see anything like that.
Yeah. And then you have Lee and Dee walking back from their date. And there's like a skip in Dee's step. And she's saying she wants to hear again what Lee said to the quorum. And he said that, you know, we can see this as a tragedy or we can see it as an opportunity. We are freed from the prophecies of Pythia. We are freed from expectation. We are free to go where you want to go, do what you want to go, within whoever you want to be. And basically, you know, it's all about how Lee saw it as an opportunity. And she's like, you know, oh, that's brilliant. And then they kiss. And then she goes into the officer's mess where Gator is. And he's like, you're glowing. And she looks at the picture of herself as a child she's got up there and she hangs up her dog tags and her wedding ring and then seemingly out of fucking nowhere shoots herself.
Yes.
I say seemingly because she was clearly really upset on the beach and in the Raptor afterwards and clearly wasn't quite right when she was babysitting Hera.
Yeah.
But the fact that she, and Lee mentions this later, the fact she comes back glowing and seems to be happy.
Mm.
And the only thing I can think of is actually an episode of Babylon 5 that we watched recently, where the character of Ivanova is talking about her mum, who committed suicide. And she says that her mum came downstairs to see her playing and she asked, because she was only a kid, if her mum wanted to join in. And her mum said, no, I just want to watch you. And it was only later that Ivanova found out that she wanted one perfect memory to take with her to heaven.
Hmm. Difference there is, obviously, A, you don't see it.
No, you don't.
And B, you were already told that her mum had killed her. So this wasn't the shock news. This, I mean, there are two big issues with this. One, yes, they're probably right. They rightly decided to lose some characters towards the end because, you know, that's BSG. It's the way it's always rolled. You don't know who's going to last from episode to episode. And it makes sense that the despair of their destination being destroyed is going to lead to suicides in the fleet.
And you get as well that somebody will.
Hmm.
And I think I would argue that it has more impact and has more feeling if it's someone you know.
Exactly.
But I'm not being funny. We don't have to see it. We just don't. It's horrible.
Yeah, and not only that, but to use such a horrible event as a shock moment, which is what they do.
Yeah.
Because there's absolutely no warning this is about to happen. And Ronald D. Moore is completely open on the commentary. That's what he's doing.
Yeah.
He felt they needed to up the ante on the shock value of the series. Well,
you didn't.
Hard cheese if you experienced the pain and grief of a suicide. Because, you know, We're doing this for the ratings, baby,
but it's
basically
not just that. It's not just hard cheese if you experience the pain and grief of a suicide. It's also hard cheese if you're struggling with suicidal thoughts and you're just about winning against them, and then you watch this, and that tips you over the edge.
Yeah,
I'm sorry, but he's complicit in something here, one more, because if it had been properly signposted, then anybody watching this could take the decision to turn it off. Couldn't they? If they had no idea at the time and you can see it coming, you're like, actually, you know what? No.
I mean, it needs a big spoiler warning at the start. Yeah, that this story contains a suicide.
Yeah.
So that if people know that that's something they can't face watching, they can choose not to watch it.
Or,
but to just jump it on you.
No, it's not right.
Absolutely no. There's not even a lead up with getting a gun and putting it to a head and then changing mind and then later on doing it, which I've seen in other shows. So at least then you're kind of prepared for it. But the whole point is, he doesn't want you to be prepared for it. He wants it to come as a massive shock.
Well, when they did it with Sharon, I know it was an attempted suicide, but it wasn't out of nowhere. It went on for a little bit in terms of the preparatory scenes, and you could see what she was going to do. So if that had been a problem for
you. And in some ways, that was kind of more justified by the fact that she wasn't a human being. So, you know.
And now we see Cylons as people, but we didn't at that point.
And, you know, you expect. Sorry, snoring dog. You expect her not to be in her right mind because of what she's been through, because she had the whole being switched on.
But you don't get that from Dee, enough of it.
No, nothing. And the other massive issue is the feeling that Dee is being fridged here.
Yeah.
Because she's been killed off just for impact's sake and how it'll affect the other male characters.
Which is horrible.
I mean, given the gender swap intentions at the start of the series, it would have been a lot better if it had been one of the male characters.
Why can't Leodama kill himself just because he doesn't know who the fuck he is and what he's doing with his life?
It was never going to be him. But, I mean, Gator would have made a lot more sense considering the frame of mind he's in.
Yeah, and we would have seen it coming, wouldn't we?
A little more, yes.
A little more. But I think as well, the other thing with this is if you put a content warning ahead of something, then it isn't necessarily that people won't watch, or in our case of our podcast, won't listen. Sometimes it's about, okay, I can manage that, for example, when I'm with someone, but I won't manage it when I'm on my own.
Yeah.
Or I can manage that if I know I've got something specific to look forward to afterwards. I can manage that with self-care in place. Some people do misunderstand the idea of a content warning, that it means people are always going to avoid something. And some people will have to, and that's fine. But some people won't. It's just about knowing in advance and putting self-care in place.
And ultimately, it's a sad indictment. They didn't know what to do with Dee's character since Lee dumped her, which is appalling in itself.
It's horrible. It's horrible. I mean, there are all sorts of things they could potentially have done with Dee. Why not make her one of the Cylons rather than fucking Anders? just as an example. You know, I mean, I like what they've done with Tori in terms of I don't like her. It's a love to hate. That they've made her a complete bitch. They've done interesting things with her.
They rightly decide, because up to that point, she really hadn't been a major character, but they realised they needed a female final five member, and I think they made the right decision there, because it gave that character a lot more of an interesting dimension it didn't have before.
And because she didn't have too much previous, it allowed them to explore a Cylon revelling in being evil.
So it's not like they always make the wrong decision, they just really do here, I'm afraid,
as far as I'm concerned. It's very, very wrong. Yeah. I like you, I think. Whilst I can understand the idea that somebody does, given what's happened, I think in a way it would be unrealistic if nobody did.
Yeah, exactly, yes.
But actually, like you, I think he should have been Gator. Mm. I think he was earmarked for it, given how depressed he already was.
Well, ironically, of course, then in the minisode that's set after this, he does try and commit suicide.
Exactly, then you could have argued that that was sufficient warning at the time, potentially. But no. It's horrific, it's unnecessary. It's uncalled for, and without a proper content warning, it's damaging and it's reckless.
Yeah. Anyways, moving on.
So then you've got Adama being drunk.
Yes, getting a gun off somebody. I love that. Sidearm.
Yeah.
Stalking down the corridor.
And then it just goes fucking odd, okay? Because I get this. He walks up to Saltine, and actually, to be honest, before I knew, I didn't remember this, it wasn't memory, but when you see him walking up the corridor with a sidearm, I'm thinking he's going for Saul, isn't he? You know what I mean? It's just like, you could see it coming, do you know what I mean? And then he's like, he's threatening to, he's going to shoot Saul. No, he's going to provoke Saul into shooting him.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And Tigh sees it and goes, no. I'm not doing that. And he unloads the clip. And then they have a conversation about dogs chasing foxes.
And it shouldn't be dogs. It should be Daggett, surely. They don't have dogs. They have Daggetts.
But do they even have foxes? Well, presumably. But anyway.
Well, yes, that ought to be called something else as well. But never mind.
Yeah. Anyway, and then these foxes would be chased by the dogs, and that some of them would turn and fight, and some of them would jump into the river, and then some of them would be found later on by fishermen out at sea because they just let the current take them, and this is somehow a metaphor for not coping anymore or something. And I just, fuck off. I'm sorry. Just fuck the fuck off. What was your response to that scene?
Yeah, the mostly annoyance that they weren't calling him Daggett.
Fair enough.
It's just inconsistencies like that. Would, again, it's taking me out of it, is it?
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of along the theme suicidal letting yourself be taken away by the tide sort of thing, but...
Yeah. Yeah, but then I just reckon that what these people do, okay, is they go, what sounds intellectual for an episode title? Let's pick this shit. And then they try and fit an episode round the bollocks. And so they've inserted this awful scene that started off so well with Saul and Adama having the face-off that they've been needing to have and everything else. And then it becomes bollocks about foxes.
Yeah,
because that's what
the rails
they
at that
thought.
Point, yeah.
They had to do because that was the shit title of that they chose.
I think, to be fair, the title came afterwards, but yeah.
It was still bollocks.
It is bollocks, yes.
They should have gone with Tigh and Tide Wait for No Man.
Obviously.
Yes, because I came up with that. So it must be better. And it isn't Latin and it isn't wanky. It's terrible. There you go. And then you have Lee reducing the survivor count, and Kara initially goes to him to say, you know, I really need to talk to someone, but she hasn't heard about Dee. And again, this is where, if they'd got the previous bit right, and it had been Gator, there'd been warnings, and we hadn't actually seen it, the following scene with a relevant person would have been actually very powerful, because Lee says he has no idea why it happened and probably never will. And that is true for some families and some friends. And it had the potential, it's a very well acted scene, it had the potential to be a powerful scene, but it isn't, because you're still either shocked, hurting, or fucking angry at what the writers have done earlier.
Yeah.
And then you have Adama and Tigh going to C&C, and they've decided to look for a nearby planet. And this is something that actually is better explained in your episode, the rationale. But you just like, you know, are there any... They say something like F, G or K class or something like that.
Yeah.
Which I presume is like the equivalent of the Starfleet M class.
Yeah.
Whereas Deanna sits on the shore, so she isn't going with the fleet. She wants to die with the bones of her ancestors. So she's, again, feeling despondent and she doesn't want to face Cavill. And again, if she had been the one who had committed suicide, it would have been interesting if it had been a Cylon that had done it. But it would have been flagged, because when she's resurrected by Cavill, she says to him, you promised me that this would be the end. You promised me I would never come back.
Yeah.
They could have taken a different tack here and didn't. And then she's like, you know, don't you just want to stop all this? Everything has happened before, everything has happened again. And Saul responds with, and ride the tide out to sea. So he starts walking into the water. And then he finds a fragment of a locker.
Did you know, I think it was slightly Hitchhikers. You expected him to start casting his clothing off as he went. There was that scene where it's actually Douglas Adams who does it in the TV series, and he just wades out into sea because there's something about, you know, the human race deciding that it was all a big mistake and going back to meet their ancestors in the waters, basically.
Anyway, he picks up a fragment of a locker, and then he gets a memory of him in a suit and tie. And I don't know whether he is, but my brain said he was a school teacher. And then he's sort of digging out the rubble, and he uncovers a memory of Ellen. And she says, it's okay, everything is in place. We will be reborn again together. And he comes out of the sea saying, Ellen, she's the fifth Cylon. And that's the thing that I had remembered when we were recording the last...
I thought I knew who the fifth was, and it wasn't. I didn't think it was Ellen, so I was wrong. So that was quite nice to find that out. And that one would have been quite powerful had the episode not earlier been ruined for me, really.
Yeah,
so.
I think so. It really would have been. As I said, I spent most of the time not remembering. I remembered recently. It would have been a brilliant dramatic ending if they'd got the earlier part of the episode right. But they didn't.
Yeah.
And it clouds everything.
It does rather, yes.
So I think if you can imagine this episode with either Deanna or Gator being the suicide victim,
and with a trigger warning,
with a trigger warning, with a proper lead up, and you don't actually see it, then A, that particular scene with Lee and Starbuck, it wouldn't necessarily have been Lee, but anyway, that scene, so well acted, so emotional, would have been very powerful. And B, that scene right at the end would have been incredibly powerful. But as it is, nah, they fucked up.
Well, let's find out what other people thought. Sampo and Yona have this to say. Hello, hope you had a good Christmas. We at least did. And a good thing too, I'm not sure we could have taken this episode otherwise. So as seen in the last episode, Earth is a radioactive wasteland, and this episode mainly follows the reaction of the characters to the new situation. Let's look at Roslyn first. On the planet, she finds a plant, very Wally, and she proceeds to just rip it out of the ground. This is why you can't have nice things.
Yes!
They fly up to the Galactica and Roslyn just completely shuts down and refuses to face the situation. Then Starbuck finds her own body or something. This is clearly a mystery box that we return to later. It was worth it to see Leoben being dumbstruck for once instead of his usual smug self. Yes. The most notable, indeed the most shocking part of the episode is Dee shooting herself. It came totally out of nowhere for Yona. It did for everybody. Yeah. It did for me, and I'd seen this before at some point, but I'd forgotten all about it. It was an extra shock since Dee was one of her favourites, but I remembered where it was going, so seeing Dee being happy with Lee was extra heartbreaking. It also showed very well that when people are suicidal, it's not easy to see it from the outside. The whole sequence was very effective. We especially appreciated the lack of music. Since Dee has always been one of the more sane people around, it really hammers home how dire the situation was, which is true.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have had so much of a problem with it being Dee had there not had at least been a warning that the episode was going to contain a suicide. I mean, better characters to have chosen, but yeah.
I think the other thing for me, given going back to what you were saying about the fridging, is Dee has barely been in this season.
Yeah, I know, that's the thing. Unfortunately, it's her being killed off because they didn't know what else to do with her.
Yeah, whereas you wouldn't have had the same feeling that that's what they were doing if she'd had a role to play since Lee dumped her.
Yeah. Speaking of bedrocks crumbling, Adama walks around the Galactica with a gun and a bottle of booze as discipline around him is breaking down.
That's true, yeah.
The scenes of him walking through corridors are very effective. He goes to pick a fight with Tigh with a bottle of booze and a gun. And when Tigh says that you should stop drinking, you know you have a problem.
Yes, yes.
Things eventually calm down and they agree that there are two choices here, give up or go on, and giving up is not really an option. It's a nice message in the end. Also throughout the episode, we learned things about Earth. Apparently the world was populated by humanoid Cylons, and our final four have flashbacks to their old lives 2,000 years ago. Another mystery box to be unravelled. We also learned that Ellen is the final Cylon, something I did remember, but it did come out of nowhere originally. But on this rewatch, I've noticed that they have mentioned Ellen regularly, so that the viewers don't forget about her. Yes, I mean,
yes, true.
Her cropping up as Six recently, for instance. This puts the episode where Ellen originally came on board the Galactica into a new light. Did Baltar actually know she was a Cylon? He tested her, but it was left ambiguous. Most likely not. It was pretty unclear that his Cylon detector even worked, yes.
Yeah.
Yona was pleased, since she was sure Ellen was a Cylon back then, and finally she was proven right.
Yep.
Also, the stuff about a planet full of Cylons started doing her head in. Are there really only 12 Cylon models if there was a planet full of them? Actually, that's a point, because a lot of the faces you see aren't any of the 12, are they?
No.
Around Tyrol.
So my thinking with that is that are there only 12 models that survived to go forward?
Mm. And what number does Hera have?
Presumably 13. 14, effectively.
13.
13.
Yeah.
13?
13! 13! 13! 13! Now you got it? Damn it!
I just told her this is a discussion we should have after the series is over because I really can't remember what we are still about to learn and what we should figure out for ourselves. So a really, really heavy episode, you don't say, but one that somehow manages to pull off some hope at the end instead of just swimming out to sea and letting itself drown. Really excellent stuff. So I didn't mind it so much.
Yeah. In terms of what the Cylons look like and how they're seeing themselves, and this is where you tell me whether I'm totally barking up the wrong tree or not, but I saw it as kind of like a perception filter, that they were placing themselves as they look now in those memories, and they haven't necessarily always looked like that.
Not convinced that's the case.
Okay, but that's how, and it, a bit like the Buddhist concept of rebirth. Mm-hmm. You're not necessarily going to look the same in your next incarnation. That was how I thought of it, but I'm not sure that was seeded. I think that was just my own brain.
Mm-hmm.
And we've heard from Jeff, who writes, "This might be the bleakest episode of television I've ever watched. If the show had just ended with revelations, I think that would have been downright cheery by comparison. In fact, it was almost comical by the end, how much darkness and despair the writers piled on. Despite being incredibly acted, I had to laugh during Adama and Tigh's confrontation. It was just too much. Or maybe it was just a defence mechanism and deflection kept me from dealing with it directly. Or maybe your just brain was fucked up by the conversation about foxes. Still, I'm quite intrigued by some of the plot developments. The past lives recollections of the Final Four raises a host of fascinating questions, and Kara finding her own body in the crashed Viper is exquisitely enigmatic. In any other series, I would suspect some kind of timey-wimey predestination paradox, but I don't think Galactica will go there. Finally, poor Dee. I'm actually angry about this development. They seem to have forgotten all about the character, only to bring her back to kill her in a shocking manner.
Yeah, that's kind of how it feels, yeah.
It's actually a disturbing pattern because they did the same thing with Callie.
To an extent, yeah. It wasn't quite, it didn't feel quite so bad with Callie, but yeah, it's there as well.
Despite that, all the Candice McClure did an amazing job portraying an undercurrent of despair even in those scenes where she was outwardly laughing and happy. I'm not sure how I feel about the revelation of Ellen Tigh as the fifth secret Cylon. It seems awfully convenient and perhaps even cheapens the character's tragic story arc. Ironically, Season 1's Tie Me Up, Tie Me Down was on television right after I switched off the Blu-ray. It was amusing looking back at that one and the suspicions that Ellen was a Cylon way back then.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
You all. Let's see what Purry made of it.
Hello, Orgs, and a happy new year to everyone out there, yourselves and to everyone out there in Borgcast land. Purry here to talk about sometimes a great notion. So we're following up, obviously, with a nice, cheery, chirpy, light-hearted episode to get us over the grim darkness of the end of the previous one. Ah, I'm kidding. This is yet more relentless grimness, which is a lovely way to start 2021. It is a good episode. The standout parts here for me are the scene between Adama and Tigh. Again, those two play off each other so well, and indeed almost in general, once again, is brilliant, just with the way he slowly breaks down over the episode. He is initially trying to hold things together, but as Rosalind breaks down, and particularly as Dee, I mean, the actual scene with him and Lee in the sick bay when you're expecting him to say something vaguely profound and he just kind of pulls out a bottle and goes, "I don't know what's happening." And we do get that bit at the end where he's kind of pulled himself together a little and he's now, you know, saying, "Right, we're going to find a new home. We'll see if the Cylons want to come along." The other standout part was, of course, the kind of bit with Duala. And indeed, we do kind of focus on her a bit through the episode. Her initial kind of depression over the end of the last episode, and also we get she sort of goes through various things. She sees I can't remember the name of the creepy child for Halo and Boomer, but Halo and Boomer's creepy child. She looks after her. She goes on a date with Lee, has a thoroughly nice time, and then shoots herself in the head in a scene which, I mean, I knew it was coming, and it's still kind of shocking, just the absolute speed at which it comes in. And indeed, there is that concept of her wanting kind of one, you know, she's got a head, she's in about the nicest place she can be, but she's lost any hope. And I think that's an impression you get as you see fights breaking out, graffiti, you know, on the ship and that sort of thing. There's definitely a sign that things are beginning to fall to bits. And, you know, at the end, we do sort of get a sense that maybe things are going to pull together, but the last episode maybe doesn't show it. There are also some revelations about the Cylons that, in fact, that planet was populated entirely by Cylons, and really, while we talk about the Final Five being the Final Five, I think it's getting more and more likely that they're kind of the first five, which makes me wonder how kind of things got together. Did they initially meet up with, you know, is there kind of a thing where everyone develops their own Cylons, but the kind of human Cylons then meet up with them? And if so, that's kind of interesting. It'd probably been somewhere Caprica might have gone, but got axed, so didn't. But again, you know, it's that sort of interesting thing. But also this circular idea that they're talking about, you know, that everything has happened before and will happen again. And indeed, that was their first thought, was they built Cylons and blew themselves up. So there's quite a lot of interesting stuff. And again, just some very good performances from everyone. Even Lee's very good. I wasn't hating on Apollo. Starbuck finds out that she's dead. Or at least she thinks she's dead. It was someone wearing her dog tag. She burns the body. But the downside is that's a new mystery opened up as to, well, if Starbuck died on that planet, then what's Starbuck? We don't know. Although one of the things I have noticed is that, and I think a lot of us have been doing it in the podcast, we tend to be calling her Kara more than Starbuck, which I'm wondering if that's an interesting thing that we're all kind of picking up on something's different. As far as I know, people in the show aren't caught treating her any differently, but it was just an interesting observation. So I'll be back in a bit to talk about sometimes a quiet does something to my soul. I don't know, but I'll be back to talk about that episode in a moment. But until then, bye for now.
Bye.
Yeah, I'm not sure that Starbuck finding her body was a particularly new revelation to me, to be honest, because we knew that she blew up.
Yeah.
I suppose it's more of a revelation that there were only bits left after that big bang and how the hell they've ended up on Earth, but...
It's a revelation to her, which I can understand. What I find interesting is that it's also a revelation to Leoben.
Mm. But ultimately, it's not any more or less of a mystery, because we knew that this isn't the same Kara that, you know, that they killed off in the end, towards the end of season three. So.
And it can't be. We knew it couldn't be because the Viper came back pristine.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's clearly not been the same person. So.
Yeah. Mm. And what was interesting is that, well, I remember what first time around watching this, when she found her own body, I automatically thought she was a Cylon and that therefore she was the fifth of the final five.
Mm.
But in that very same episode, you find out it's Ellen. And I can remember at the time going, what the fuck? Because I thought that that's where it was all leading.
Yeah, see, I thought it was Starbuck as well, yeah.
Yeah. And yes, you know, the final five are the first five. And for me, that also does raise the question of the other seven. Were the other seven originally there? Or is it only the final / first five that were on Earth and the other seven are new? What did Drew and Tracy make of this?
So we've just watched Sometimes a Great Notion.
We did.
And what do we think of that one then?
Yeah, it's a bit miserable.
It was very miserable. Mucho miserable.
Yeah. It started off and I was like, this is a bit of a downer beginning. And then it got to a downer middle and a downer end.
Yeah. It was just like, didn't have any ups in this one at all, did it?
No.
What I have to say is, surely, didn't Galactica do any kind of scans on Earth to kind of see what they were getting themselves in for before they actually landed? I mean, how did they know that it was going to be hospital bill? I mean, what were they expecting?
Well, they... I mean, don't forget that we only see them, like, jump, and then the next minute we see them on it. I would imagine they couldn't scan it until they jumped
to the location.
But they've been
searching for Earth. They've done a lot of research on what Earth.
Yeah, but they couldn't scan the planet until they got there. And I would have thought, when they got there, they might have scanned it and gone, something is not right
here.
No life.
The radiation levels are not quite good here.
But they would have definitely have still said, let's go down and check it out, I would have thought.
Okay. Might have to beg to differ on that one.
Okay.
It's good to see the original Centurion helmet.
It looked like it. Well, I don't know if it's quite original, but it certainly looked very reminiscent.
Well,
yes.
They were quite clearly saying, no, not one of ours.
Yes.
Not one of ours.
Yeah, exactly.
But I think it is, love.
Yep.
So I started writing down, what the fuck is going on with Starbuck? When they started finding bits of her ship, I was like, oh, is Starbuck going to turn out to be one of the final five? Because it's been kind of alluding to that for quite a long
time.
Well,
the fact that it seems to be her dead body in the thing, how come she's still around?
Well, it can't seem to be, can it? It's got her
dog tags
and the wedding ring and things like that. I'm just wondering if during this kind of season, she wanted an out for some reason and they had to write her out for a bit and then they had to find a ludicrous way of getting her back.
She was only out of like for about an episode or two, wasn't it?
But in real terms, that might have been quite a while.
I don't think that's
the case.
In
production terms.
But yeah.
Maybe I'm just being a bit...
Yeah, so you thought she was going to be...
I thought she was going to be one of the final five.
Yep.
And then didn't I get a slap in the face?
Well, right at the end.
Yeah.
Yes, so the reveal it is Ellen.
So all I had to write down was Ellen the Slapbot is one of the final five.
Slapbot, yeah. Yes. Yeah, and I'm surprised you didn't remember it.
No, I didn't. I remembered quite a lot of this episode, actually, like... Not how bleak it was, but I remember as soon as Dee was in the officer's hall, I was like,
straight back
on,
to me as well. It's an awful
and
moment.
That was hard.
Poor Dee as well. Such a nice, lovely character. And Not a good way to go.
No, I mean, a kind of, in a way, it was nice that she got to have a nice evening before she'd obviously kind of decided to take that step. But I found it very hard for Lee, because obviously he thought that there was a bit of a reconciliation coming there. And not to be.
Nope.
Adama, he takes the weight of the fleet on his shoulders.
Or I guess he kind of thinks the buck stops with him.
Yeah, but every time he loses one of his crew or something really, really bad happens, he's always let you down. And, you know, he can't be held responsible for everything. He's doing his best, for goodness sake.
Yep.
And I did feel like when he went to see Tigh,
yeah,
as much as he wanted a row with him, he wanted to talk to his best mate.
Maybe, yeah. Cause
there was quite a lot in
there.
Yeah,
after the initial major incident with the
guns. It was the first
time
they really spoke to each other.
Yeah, then they did seem to very quickly go back to how things were.
Yeah, and you just, I don't know. Mm. I felt sorry for them. I thought this was a very depressing...
It was, yeah. I mean, I'm not saying, you know, it wasn't rubbish or anything, but just, yeah, full-on bleakness, really. Which, you know, this is a bleak series, but this was... turned up to 11, really.
I couldn't quite understand when Kira was kind of inferring that that was her dead body in the Viper,
yep,
or whatever it was. Lee Oban's kind of done a flit, like he couldn't handle it or
something.
Yeah,
I know. Well, he's in a bit of shock as well, because everything he's thinking was going to be coming true is also not turning out to be true.
Well, everything is flip reversing and turning on its backside, isn't it?
Perhaps this episode should have become Revelations, because there's more revelations
absolutely
in this, really, isn't there?
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, it's a good episode, but obviously totally bleak.
Yeah, a bit down.
Yep.
Totally down.
Let's hope the next one's a bit more up.
I need some Christmas jolliness after this one.
Yep.
Anyway, shall we leave it there?
Okie dokie.
Okie dokie. See you later, guys.
Bye. Yeah, it is more than a bit miserable. It's miserable at the beginning, it's miserable in the middle, and it's miserable at the end. Yep.
You're right, the Leoban stuff is good.
Yeah.
That's one of the highlights of the episode, really, is seeing him go, I don't know anymore.
And Revelations would have been a better name for this one.
It would have been, yes. But then sometimes a great notion wasn't a great title anyway. So.
No. And, yeah, you would have thought that they would have taken scans of Earth before they landed, so they'd be forewarned that they might be facing something really quite bleak, and so Roslyn would have been forewarned, and potentially the fleet could have been, and then they wouldn't have been all expecting her to
Yeah, they did kind of address that in the episode. Somebody says to Adama, shouldn't we send down a scout party? And he said, like, no, we're beyond scout parties now. Let's, you know, all go down before rumour gets out of control or something like that. So the idea is they all experience it together. That's why you get the whole gamut of people on the beach. There.
Yeah, I can understand why it's everyone, not just a scout party. But Drew says they could have taken scans. We know from previous episodes they can scan planets for shit, like water.
Well, yeah, like water, but they would have just picked up water. They're not necessarily, you know, the fact that it's a... We've yet to find out that they've picked up on a planet being irradiated before now, so...
Yeah. But one of the things they were talking about, how there aren't any people there, there isn't any life. They were expecting to find people. You would have expected them to do... I thought so. You were expecting them to find life signs.
Don't know.
The 13th tribe. And so, therefore, if they'd done a scan and not found any, that should have flagged it up.
Hmm. But, yeah, they were kind of, by design, in a hurry, basically. So.
Yeah. I love the phrase, Ellen the Slutbot.
Yes, my life. Well, something tells me that the Llama God isn't going to be too happy with this episode, so let's find out.
Yes, I am. I'll show you what I can on the signs.
All right, then. Well, they said it was going to get darker in this season, half-season, didn't they? And it certainly does, doesn't it? This is such a cheery opener, with all hope of them having a new home and being able to escape from their cramped, trapped lives where they can't go out and meet other people and mix freely. All those hopes have been dashed. And yeah, that's just really not what I'm going to be watching at the moment, is it? I'm not quite sure we're going to the same sort of level of despair that they end up in the on Galactica, but, you know, it's getting close now, isn't it? But... really, the main thing I come away from this episode with is an incredible sense of annoyance and anger, because yes, they've done it again. They fridged another female character in order to give other characters something to be upset about. Yes, Dee kills herself in this episode because she's so unhappy about what's going on. I mean, yeah, okay, it's a completely reasonable response, and either in this episode or the next one, we do find out that suicides are up in the fleet, and given that they've actually lost all hope now, the thing they were chasing is gone, then yeah, it's understandable. But why Dee? Why did it have to be Dee? Having thought about that question, there are other characters you could have sacrificed, yes, but what it comes down to really at this juncture is if you want to kill someone off for this particular reason, someone who's lost all their hope, then there's not very many choices left, are there? A lot of these secondary characters have turned out to be Cylons, and they weren't ever going to do anything like that with Apollo or Starbuck, were they? So this is where we come down to. Maybe it could have been the President, but again, another female character losing hope. She's alive, but without hope, that's a different thing. So really, Dee is possibly the only character they could have easily sacrificed, especially given that characters like Anders are now Cylons. So yeah, and that says other things about the show as well, doesn't it? About how they treat their secondary female characters and how they don't really have that much to do aside from, well, being Lee's husband. That's all she was really good for in the end, wasn't it? At least as far as the story writers were concerned. Anyway, she had a lot more to offer as a character and an actress. So yeah, this is a bit of a damning indictment of how they view the characters. And that said, why not Hot Dog? Or maybe why not Gator? Gator's lost his leg. He's lost a lot of hope. He's lost the will. Why not have him be the one that commits suicide and have everyone tear up about it as well? No, they can't, because he's a man. And also because he has to focus in the next episode. I won't go into that just yet, in case anyone's listening to these orders. But yeah, there's a lot of stuff that could have been done differently, and it didn't have to be Dee. And really, after Callie in the last half of the season, this is starting to get particularly uncomfortable and noticeable. So yeah. And it's a shame, because there is some good stuff in this episode. There's a lot of good stuff in here. The whole atmosphere of despair, hopelessness, I mean, that's all coming across very, really well. There's some fantastic stuff from Eddie Olmos and Michael Hogan as Tigh and Adama have their long anticipated face off, with Tigh once again proving that he is a good man, regardless of whether he's a man or not, in the way that he handles the situation. That's some great stuff there. Also some wonderful mystery where Kara discovers that she is actually dead, so she discovers that she is actually the best at respawning. So yeah, now she's been able to go back and loot her corpse. That's a bit odd, isn't it? I think that just adds a nice interesting little layer to the mystery. If she's not who she is, but she's also not a Cylon, then who or what is she? So yeah, I like that side of the mystery. That's nice. And we also get to learn that it's damn millennials that caused the downfall of Earth, because if Tyrell hadn't picked up the avocado, things would have gone very differently, I'm sure. Yeah, bloody millennials, their avocados on toast. It will be the end of us all, won't it? And of course, the final reveal. And I've forgotten this one, actually. But yes, that Ellen was apparently the final fifth Cylon. So yeah, that's a bit awkward now, isn't it? So that's unfortunate. But they found her, so they don't need her anyway. So yeah, bit of a shame there. Yeah, she's another character who had to be killed because she was female and inconvenient and exists now only in memory to give a male character some deep existential angst. So yeah, that's a nice, great reminder there at the end of the episode, isn't it? Yeah. Even Deanna, who's one of the stronger of the Cylon characters, even she is made to exit the series by just giving up and dying. So basically another suicide here, but because she's given up. So yeah, and that's another woman doing it. Surely that should be the response of Leoben, especially given how devoted and fanatical he was to Kara. This must have been a double blow to him. So to have Deanna do it in his stead, I mean, maybe Lucy Lawless wanted out the series or something, I don't know, but no, this is just not a great look at all. So yeah, in all, a damn shame. This could have been a lot better, but it's really very clumsy, and their treatment of female characters is really starting to show. So yeah, let's see if they can do anything better in the next one. Yeah?
Yeah, Lucy Lawless was only back for a limited couple of episodes, basically.
Yeah.
So she was going to get written out. I suppose we ought to be grateful that they didn't write her out by her directly committing suicide, but it's effectively what she chooses to do, and I don't think we get to see her again, sadly.
No, but at least that was foreshadowed by what she had said.
Mm-hmm.
And had it been the only one, I wouldn't have had a problem with it. But it's not the only one in this episode.
It had to be Dee because they didn't know what else to do with her. That's the sad fact.
But they've never known what the fuck to do with Lee. Kill Lee!
Yeah, well, they've always come up with a billion and one different options for him. They couldn't
why couldn't they do that for Dee?
Mm-hmm.
Make her be the random character. Nobody knows what she's doing this particular week. And then just Lee Adama kills himself because he's just like, I'm Lee Adama. Why do I exist? Bang.
Again, wasn't going to happen, sadly.
Should have done.
No, but wasn't going to. Damn millennials. what fruit was that? I don't even know what that is.
Avocado.
It's an avocado, is it? Maybe an avocado once, I don't know.
It's the main ingredient of guacamole, which you
don't
like.
Oh, which because I have... Oh, yeah, well, there you go. That's why I don't generally pick up avocados.
I like guacamole, but I don't know what to do with an avocado.
Turn it into guacamole, obviously.
No, I don't know how.
Don't you just sit on it or something? Stamp on it a bit. Does it just not go mushy?
Yeah, but you have to add chili or something.
You'd never have guessed, would you? Watch out for my millennial cookbook now.
You're not a millennial.
Me stamping on various fruit.
You're a Gen Xer like me.
Am I? Oh, that sounds far cooler. Like I'm one of the X-Men. Excellent. Can I have schnick blades that come out of my hand and be all Wolverine?
Depends when they come out and why. I've often wondered that about Wolverine, what happens when he gets excited.
Okay, let's move swiftly on.
What did Andrew make of this?
I wondered when it was going to happen, and as soon as I heard D doing the previously on, I knew it was going to be here. It put me in mind of Ivanova's mum from Babylon 5, who watched young Ivanova play with dolls so she could have one nice memory to take with her into heaven. I think you see something similar with Dee, doing things that bring her joy, doing things that put a smile on her face. Usually in these sorts of shows, science fiction shows or action-y sorts of shows, you get suicides, but they tend to be people nobly sacrificing themselves to save other people. Did I say salves then? I meant to say selves. Or it's a suicide bomber, like we've seen earlier on in BSG, on New Caprica. And there have been Cylons who have killed themselves in order to be resurrected for various reasons, and that puts a different spin on things as well, the science fiction spin. But this is the first one that treads in the territory where the press, for instance, have had to modify their language when they talk about the subject. People don't kill themselves, people don't commit suicide, it's always death by suicide. So as to kind of abstract it a little bit, basically so as to not encourage anybody to do the same. And just parenthetically, whether you think this is a realistic and therefore a valuable depiction of how people respond to things, or whether you think this is something that might encourage viewers who are perhaps in a similar frame of mind to do the same, where you think that responsibility of the show may lie in dramatizing something like this, you can think about that in your own time. This is the kind of suicide that more commonly turns up in people's lives, in their families and in their friends. There's that saying that goes around sometimes, be kind to everyone because you never know what kind of battle they're fighting. And here is someone, Dee, who has decided that whatever this is, whatever's going to come next, is a battle that she just doesn't want to fight. And it seems quite realistic in that the people around her didn't have a clue it was going to happen. There wasn't anything that made them think anything was amiss. We as viewers are clued into it by, I think, her being in the opening previously on, but first of all, and also her muttering to herself in the raptor. So we know something has changed. I suppose that's maybe a bit of a victim of that dictum, the difference between truth and fiction is that fiction has to make sense. You need to be able to track things. I suppose if they really wanted to put us in the mindset of the characters, we wouldn't have had that early muttering to herself, that implication that something had changed. This being Battlestar Galactica, I'm sure there'd have been a thought somewhere in the viewer's mind that there was going to be a sting in the tail somewhere, that this happy day that Dee was having perhaps wasn't going to end a happy day. But I think perhaps what actually happens would have been harder to predict, as it turns out very often to be in life. But anyway, away from that, this is an interesting point in the progress of the show, the series, where effectively they've fulfilled the mission of the show. They've found Earth, it didn't turn out to be what they hoped it would be, so what are they going to do for the rest of the half season that's left? And there's a temptation to find that next thing, to build momentum to whatever's going to come next. And there is some groundwork laid for what's going to come next. But really, this episode lingers quite a lot in this aftermath of this discovery of Earth. Appropriately so, I think, given the mission of the show up until this point has been subverted. I think it's good that they actually take a good amount of time to just digest that and look backwards without much of an eye as to what's coming forwards. Thinking particularly of the leader characters, particularly President Roslin, who's experiencing a very human thing. She couldn't possibly have known that this is how the quest for Earth would have ended up, but she's blaming herself for starting that quest and blaming herself for the death of everyone they've lost along the way. And on the Cylon side, the Anna's decided that she's had enough and she's going to stay on Earth. But overall, I really like this one, which might sound like a bit of an odd thing to say given how bleak it is, but I think it's appropriate. It's an appropriate response to what they've discovered, given everything that they've experienced up until this point. It feels earned, and it doesn't feel narratively wrong, as bleak and depressing as it is. Excellent performances by everybody. I think special attention should go to Edward James Olmos for taking Adama to such a raw, ugly place, where you don't typically see your lead male characters or actors go. So yeah, I really like this one. Sometimes episodes can feel a bit like a snack. This one felt like a proper meal. This one had a lot of important stuff going on and treated it with the importance it deserved. So, thumbs up. Onwards, bye for now.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was right to address the situation they find themselves in and how you know, that's going to hit them hard, because it was all about finding Earth. They found Earth, but oh dear, it's an irradiated wasteland. I don't have an issue with that. I don't have an issue with the fact that it's going to affect people so bad, some people so badly, they commit suicide. I just think some warning before the episode started would be necessary, really, that's the sort of scenes you're going to be seeing.
Exactly. Particularly if it's true what you say, that this type of suicide is more common. Because then there's going to be even more people who are going to be affected by it. And it's particularly bad given that we see her do it. We don't just have it talked about, which would be bad enough. We see it happen. How many people who have had that in their lives, because as you said, it's the most common type, have now watched that because there's no content warning and envisaged their loved one in that scene?
Not good enough, I'm afraid, Ron Moore. Not good enough.
No,
but anyway.
Not at all. Not earned. Very narratively wrong.
The next episode, it's also not a barrel of laughs, but for completely different reasons.
Yeah.
As we will sure be finding out as we cover whatever the hell it's called. I don't know.
Fuck it, Latin, I don't care.
It's not Latin, but the episode title's Disquiet Follows My Soul. Oh, boy.
Permanent alliance between this government and the Cylons. Any Cylons is out of the question. I hope you both know that.
Yeah, well, it's not your call.
Is it yours?
Are you the president? Again? Sorry, I get confused what your job is on any given day.
Laura Roslin is still the president. She'll make the final call.
And where is Laura Roslin? Oh, that's right. Resting comfortably aboard Galactica. Funny how she kind of dropped out of sight ever since her prophecies about Earth turned out to be a bunch of crap.
We're done here.
If you try to shove an alliance with the Cylons down our throats, there'll be consequences, Admiral.
So, the title comes from a poem by Selkirk Cloud or something. That's what Google told me anyway, whoever that is. It kind of sums up the episode, though, with Disquiet everywhere, so I suppose it's a little more descriptive.
Still wanky, though.
It is very wanky, yes. Ron Moore directs for the first time.
Okay.
Which sadly means the commentary is nearly all about how he blanked out his shots, or whatever the phrase is. Yeah, rather than the writing choices, which is what I'm listening to the commentary for, but never mind. We see Adama getting ready for work, reading from a book of Emily Dickinson poetry, which is just odd and boring, to be honest. And that was the shorter scene as well. There's a second cut available of the episode on the Blu-ray, which goes on for significantly longer and is significantly worse, to be honest, as a result. Caprica 6 and Tigh are watching a CT scan of her baby.
Yeah, I'd forgotten she was pregnant.
Yeah, Tigh says he needs a drink. Cottle offers him a ciggy instead.
Oh, that's just so wrong. And at least they have a character say, you know, smoking around the baby, and he just goes, oh, she'll live. It's like, fuck off, you selfish cunt.
Ishe, that is we've seen before as a medic.
It's just like, fuck off, Cottle and his smoking, no. But I have to say, him, Tigh, being there going, oh, I need a drink, does remind me of when I told you I was pregnant with our son and you couldn't eat your dinner.
Yes. Caprica points out no Cylon with Cylon pairing has produced a child, and there are lots of cutaways to Ishe, which suggests rather obviously she isn't happy with this idea.
Yeah.
Felix is having to wait to see Cottle, bitterly. Then Tyrrell, who's still being called chief when he isn't, comes in because his lad is peeing blood, which is never good.
Ooh.
In an excellent scene, questions are being asked of Adama for having a Cylon as his XO.
Yep.
Zarek, who's been referred to as Mr. Vice President, is asked about his opinion about the Alliance. He says no comment, though he later makes it clear that will happen over his dead body. And there's a question about President Roslin, which Lee fields. So what is he now? Something Zarek understandably takes up when the conference is over. He literally says, so what are you this week?
I love that speech. It's brilliant.
It's great to have this addressed. And then there's the predictable threat to Zarek from Adama if he doesn't get his way. Originally, the teaser was Zarek then waiting until Adama left and opening a drawer with a gun in it, which I wish they kept in because it's far more powerful. The survivor count is 39,644, which is -8, some of which died in that minisode Face of the Enemy. They're talking about upgrading the civilian ships with Cylon FDLs, which we've already heard are more advanced, but Lee voices the understandable problems that will cause, especially if it needs Cylons on the ships installing them.
Because they're not going to understandably not trust them not to install other weird shit as well.
Not quite sure why Tyrrell is in on this senior meeting on the basis he's not the chief anymore, unless he's somehow representing the Cylons.
Well, I think he is from what he says.
Gator even calls him former chief at one point. Galen is struggling with his pronouns, amusingly, with Tigh asking if he'd like a chart to keep things straight.
I love that.
He says the Cylons want to be part of the fleet citizens. That's what they want to be. Adama wisely recognises it's a political decision that needs running by the president, which is fair enough, at least. Apparently, Nikki has kidney problems, and against Cottle's wishes, Ishay points out how serious things are, considering the boy is half Cylon. Then poor Doc Cottle has to point out that Tyrell isn't Nikki's father.
Yeah.
Now, that's all there because the writers wanted to keep Hera as the only human Cylon hybrid. Yeah.
It's just not necessary, and it does Callie a disservice.
It does rather, doesn't it? But there we go. Adama is trying to get hold of Roslyn, but she's too busy putting her pills in the bin. They really need to hand things over to Zarek, but that will take them back to the Adama not working with him problems. Yeah. Gage and Starbuck have a set to about his leg and Anders' guilt in the potential destruction of humanity. And she's pretty damn obnoxious about it all. She's back to being her horrible self again.
Yeah, but you can understand it. The way he approaches her, I wouldn't have been nice to him.
No, well, I don't know who's more guilty in this, really. But, I mean, he's got... Xander's that shot his bloody leg off, let's face it. He's going to be angry.
Not her. I mean, it'd be one thing if he'd approached her privately and said his piece and had a beef with her.
Yeah, well, that's the whole thing, isn't it? He's doing this, you know, for
exactly.
Show,
he's doing it for show. He's doing it to stir
but
up
it's,
shit.
But she doesn't exactly cover herself with glory either, let's face
it. No, but she already said, because she's just... I mean, I know they don't know that, but she's just discovered she's dead. And she says, I'm not in the mood, and he persists anyway. So he fucking deserves everything he gets. Come.
Yeah, but all the comments about him being a cripple weren't particularly nice either, were they? I mean, she's a... as well, to be honest, in this scene. The name she calls him. You can see everybody else in the room just looking at her with daggers, understandably.
Yeah.
So she does not cover herself with glory, and she gets what's coming to her, really. Shocking.
Yes and no. I say yes and no because you're right that she's shocking, but the point is he started it. So you can't say she gets what's coming to her.
He started it, but she escalates it, basically.
No, that is true. That is a fair assessment of the situation. He does start it. He does not have good intentions, remotely. And he is a cunt. I mean, it might be understandable that he's behaving like a cunt, but he is a cunt.
Zarek likewise leads the quorum in a meeting damning the Roslyn Adama administration for leading them to dead Earth and for suggesting an alliance with the Cylons, who were the reason why they were searching for a new home in the first place.
Which is kind of understandable.
Yep.
And I think, to me, that feeds into the whole stuff about they were kept in the dark about so much so long. They've lost trust.
Oh, yeah.
But... when they're sort of talking
I mean,
about...
he's also stirring. There's no two ways
is,
about
absolutely
it.
Absolutely, he's stirring.
But he's been given plenty of ammunition to stir with, let's face it.
But my feeling watching this is that, actually, I'm not convinced I can find fault in the criticism he makes of Roslyn.
No.
I can find fault in the criticism he makes of Adama, given that Adama's response to the situation has been, clearly our ancestors found somewhere to go. So we're going to do the same. So in other words, Adama is still showing leadership. It might not be what he promised or whatever. Fine, I'm not saying that's not a valid criticism. But Adama is still showing leadership. Roslyn isn't at all. I thought about everything he said about Roslyn and I couldn't find anything that was actually unfair.
I mean, the problem is that there is a massive power vacuum at the moment because Roslyn
huge.
Is... huge. I mean... and again, partly understandably, she's not it well. So,
no.
But she ought to officially step aside.
Exactly. She ought to. She ought to step down.
There's this thing that they're trying to get at the moment. They wanted the... who's the vice president? Is it Pence?
Yeah.
They wanted him to do with Trump because there is actually an amendment to the Constitution. This is the 24th or something like that. That enables the vice president to take over if the president's incapacitated. The argument here being incapacitated because he's a rabid fascist, but then he has been all the while. But
but
there is that thing. I mean, that's what they need here. But anyway.
But then, I don't know that it's necessarily the case in legislation, but I'm kind of getting the feeling, and certainly I think that's how the quorum and those who are agitating see it, that actually Roslyn kind of sees herself more like a pope, as though she dies in office. She's entitled to it.
No, actually, she wants to step down, but she's not. That's the problem. She needs to.
The problem is she isn't.
She wants to, but she isn't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And she really should.
And she's not, because she knows that Adama won't work with Zarek. It's like,
but that's not a reason to not step down, is it? If you're not capable of the job, It doesn't matter whether or not there's going to be someone to replace you. It doesn't matter whether or not things are going to get bad. If you're not capable of the job, you have to hold your hands up and say, I'm not capable of the job, and leave other people to sort out the problem. Because if you're not capable of the job, you're not capable of sorting the problem out either, are you?
Yeah. Anyway, Zarek calls for a motion to prevent Cylons boarding ships in the fleet without permission from that vessel's people, and only Lee opposes.
And again, given how little they've been told...
Yeah, yeah.
It's logical.
Doesn't seem unreasonable, does it?
It doesn't seem unreasonable. The idea being that each ship can make its own decision.
Yeah.
Now, they've said in the room, in the conversation, that Zarek wasn't a part of, that it's going to enable them to jump further without using up fuel. And maybe the people will be provided with that information. But you can imagine a scenario where some people decide to take the upgrades and some people decide that they won't.
I mean, Lee's point is, of course, that then divides the fleet, because, of course, you've got one half fleet not being able to catch up with the other half, but there we go. It's great to see Zarek given something to do again, anyway, because he got forgotten for a long while.
He did, and I just love his description of Lee Adama. I just, like, that's brilliant. If I didn't have an Apple phone and I could choose my ringtone, for a while I'd have his speech about Lee Adama as my ringtone, just because I found it so amusing. What role do you actually play here?
Oh, yes, early on, yeah.
Yeah.
Adama is woken up with the news that Rosalind is jogging around the ship instead of taking her latest round of treatment. She talks about resigning, but he points out that he can't work with Zarek. Oh, Cheddar, that's who you have to work with.
Yeah, exactly. You don't get to fucking choose. Yeah, He's being a cunt. They're all cunts.
She's had enough, though, and wants to enjoy her final days, which is completely understandable. You just have to
resign, hand over. And then you get to do it. Yeah.
Eddie took great delight in walking around the set with his hands in his pockets, as his uniform had pockets for the first time ever, and nobody else's did. Oh. So practically every scene in this episode, he's got his hands in his pockets. It's because he's picking up those bits of paper. Yeah. So they have to put pockets in his
uniform.
Eddie
Olmos, you know how women feel when finally they find work clothes with pockets in.
Baltar is still blabbering into the mic and to his cultists, including a boy. He says, we're not children here, right? Well, except for the ones who are children, which is quite nice.
Yeah.
That's Ron Moore's son, by the way. I know. There were scenes with Head 6, and again, this is in the longer cut, that explains his bitterness and disillusionment here. He's kind of like, he's basically putting God to the test again, as he has done several times. But it does seem a bit of a bizarre, you know, I mean, he's obviously depressed having discovered that Earth is the way it is. But there's more explanation thanks to the 6, but we don't get to see that. Gaius is now blaming God for the sins of the people, since they're obviously perfect and don't deserve to suffer. Right.
The thing is, not quite like that, but I have heard that argument put.
Oh, yeah, I know. There are plenty of people who actually think that.
That God created us as we are. He created us with the capacity to sin. Ergo, if we do sin, it's God's fault, because that's how he made us.
Yeah. Meanwhile, it turns out that Hot Dog is Nikki's father. Of course.
Which makes no fucking sense. There's no seeding there. And given that...
That literally, they were in... vaguely close proximity. That's about the only seeding that you've got there.
You know, the whole point, a key part of Callie's story, isn't it, is that she married her abuser. Hmm. And then right at the end, she's like, why did I do that? Well, if she had someone else available...
Well, wait for it. There was another option.
Oh, what the fuck?
For Kursky.
No.
Ron Moore actually seriously considered it being Figursky, and everybody talked him out of it. Can you imagine?
But it just doesn't... Another character maybe, but oh no, we only have to one person be special, it's not allowed. Fuck off, what is it? Have you got first child syndrome, Ron Moore? You can't cope with sharing. What the fuck? Wrong, no, bad, no, wrong.
News has reached CIC of the fleet's refusal to accept the Cylon FDLs. And Adama,
it shouldn't have come as a surprise,
not
though.
Really, but Adama points out it's a military decision, so it shouldn't have been made by the Quorum, which is fine, but this goes back to him making decisions about who they're allying themselves with, which is a governmental state decision, and therefore does belong with the Quorum.
No, it does, you're right, yes.
Then the news comes in of a mutiny on the Tilium refinery, and we see the Hite Khan again. The ship gets ready to jump away. Adama launches the assault raptor, commanded by Athena. So you know that's going to end well. Blimey, Charlie. That's a good choice, isn't it? And we hear Zarek over the wireless justifying armed resistance. Ship jumps away, taking all their fuel with them. Adama instead orders Athena to arrest Sarek and bring him to Galactica by deadly force if necessary.
And this is where I got a little bit confused.
Yes.
Because, morally this is, because on the one hand, Zarak is starting an armed uprising against a sitting president.
Well, he's encouraging, yeah. Yes, well...
Right, so...
How well do we know this situation?
Yeah, no, but bear with me a minute. Mm-hmm. So, looked at that way, Adama's orders make sense.
Mm-hmm.
Except that he's the vice president, and the president, even if she hasn't formally handed over power, is not present.
Mm.
And the whole point of a vice, anything could be a vice chair, vice president, whatever, the whole point of the role is that you become the president or chair or whatever.
Not only that, but it was a quorum vote 11-1.
Yeah.
So, hmm.
So, you know, you become the president, as it were, through whenever the president isn't available. That's part of the role. It's the discussion we had with the whole Tilly XO thing, isn't it? That if the captain isn't available, the XO steps up.
Mm-hmm.
So the president is available, so the XO has stepped up. So actually, in some ways, it's not encouraging an uprising against democracy. It's actually democracy taking a stand against anti-democratic powers. And it could be read either way, because it's not straightforward. And the reason it's not straightforward is because Rosalyn hasn't actually resigned when she should have done.
Yeah. Tyrrell and Hot Dog have made up, and they're going to be Nikki's two dads by the sounds of it.
Two dads.
Yes, which is kind of sweet, I guess.
Yeah.
Adama confronts Zarek in jail with proof that he's been using his office for extortion, which would match what we saw in Black Market, to be fair, threatening to reveal it to the press unless he hands over the location of the Tilium ship. Then Adama gives the paperwork to Tigh, who discovers they're just laundry reports, which is a brilliant moment.
Yeah.
If damning of Zarek, because he should have checked, really, but never mind. Athena jumps in and they board the Hittai Khan. Zarek meets with Gator about starting a revolt. And this is the stuff that feels rather too of the moment, although there are clearly major differences here, as we've already touched on, because arguably if Zarek and Gator got a load of protesters to turn up at CIC, they'd have a real point. The quorum is being overridden. There's a massive power vacuum opening as Rosalind is neither doing her duties, I mean, for good reason, nor is she handing over to Zarek as she should.
And that's the issue. It's the fact she's not handing over.
So there is a genuine grievance here. Likewise, Gator has genuinely grievances towards Starbuck, who, again, is absolutely hateful in this. Tigh, who really shouldn't be in uniform, let alone the XO, and Adama for being a law unto himself. So he kind of, for me, clearly it didn't to you, but for me, he comes across as a sympathetic and tragic character.
No, I think for me, the issue is that, number one, Tigh has proven his loyalty. He stood in that airlock.
But he is actually a Cylon.
Yeah, but that's...
And nobody has, you know, at no point has anybody...
No, but he is, but unlike Sharon, who when she found out, Sharon Boomer, who couldn't override her programming and shot Adama... He's found out he's a Cylon, he's taken it on board, and he's gone, I don't care, this is where my loyalties lie.
I mean, there's possibly an argument there for enabling him to continue in the military, but to be as senior as the XO as a Cylon seems a big ask for most people.
And I'm not sure, and the specific reason I'm not sure is because he put himself in that airlock. Like, if he hadn't done that, I'd be with you.
Yeah. No, I'm not saying this as I think Ty's dodgy. I don't think it. I think he's being amazingly honourable. But you can see why people in the fleet are going, hang on a minute, the XO is a Cylon, really?
No, that I can understand.
Again, the Cylon's the whole reason we're out here. You know, you can quite understand why people like Gator are like, what the hell? You know.
And again, this comes down to communication where you and I agree. Hmm. If there had been something communicated by Adama... where he had officially said to the whole fleet...
Anyway, my point being, this is in direct contrast to the overprivileged Jamiroquai-styled whiny babies who've never known a moment's hardship in their life being allowed to storm the seat of democratic government when it's enacting the actual will of the people, after all.
Yes.
So they're not really comparable situations. All right, we've got a new, you know, revolt on our hands here, but it's a very different sort of
thing. It is
revolt.
A very different... I mean...
I don't know whether that makes us or BSG the darker timeline, to be honest. But there we go.
I don't know. I mean, going back specifically to Gator, you're right, he does have a genuine grievance with Starbuck, but she didn't know she was married to a Cylon. But she was a shit commander on the shit ship, wasn't she?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that grievance is legit. But
yeah,
that's
I mean, ultimately, her lack of command in that situation resulted in... All right, she didn't shoot his leg off, but her lack of command over somebody that should have been, you know...
Yeah, but I think my problem is, if I'm honest, is that when he goes to her and he confronts her, he doesn't say, you are a shit commander painting with poo...
No,
and that's
but it,
why I lost my leg.
No, but he does bring up the fact, of course, he was put on trial and nearly spaced by a jury that included her and, as it turns out, two Cylons.
Yeah.
So, again, I can quite understand his grievances.
That I can understand, but the fact that he blames her for Anders as if she knew, she didn't. If he had blamed her for what happened on the basis of the fact
she was
a shit captain, because
she was,
that would have been, for me, a fair grievance. But to me, he's going, you know, how dare you? Your husband was a Cylon. Well, she didn't fucking know. And he should know that she didn't fucking know. So, you know, it doesn't feel fair.
But, I mean, ultimately, he's too caught up in his bitterness. And you can understand where the bitterness comes from.
Yeah, and that's been seeded.
Yeah, yeah.
And you can absolutely understand where it comes from and why it happens. And like you say, it's not like Kara's an angel. Don't get me wrong. I'm just saying that what he should be doing is criticising her. And it's one of those things that I read very much as being written by a man. She's criticised for the actions of her man.
Mm-hmm.
Almost as though her own actions carry no weight. And that's one of the reasons it really, really makes me take against him.
Mm.
What I wanted to see and should have seen is absolutely all the stuff about the circle. That's dead right.
Yeah.
But when he goes for her, he should go for her, not her man.
Oh, that's fair enough, yeah. Anyway, we finish up with Adama and Rosalind in bed, not caring about anything other than their time together, which is sweet. If irresponsible, I can't
feel it. And I think that's partly why it reminded me of what's it from the motion picture, Ilya?
Ilya, yeah.
In that she kind
Beyond
of...
Beyond the lack of hair.
The lack of hair Ilya Vija person bot thing doesn't have any sense really of responsibility or stuff. It's all a bit weird shit, isn't it? Partly because it's the motion picture. But it has to be told, no, you do need to care about stuff and things.
Yeah, that's because she's basically a robot. It's a bit different to the situation, but never mind.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, it nicely sets up what I suspect will be the final conflict within the fleet, given that we've got less than half of the season left now. We have seen this sort of falling out before, but it's good that we get a final reckoning with Zarek, I think, because he was kind of sort of overlooked too often in the past.
Yeah.
I think there's got to be some sort of final showdown. So,
I think that's right. I think it's right that... Gator's genuine and real pain and frustration come to something.
Mm.
And yes, I got angry and called him a cunt, but actually, although I don't like the fact that he was having a go at Kara for Anders rather than Kara for Kara, and that's bad writing, overall, I think it's good writing that he doesn't just suck it up. Do you know what I mean? That his bitterness and all the shit he's been through goes somewhere. One of the things that I liked about the Deep Space Nine episode that I think had a shitty Latin name but was good about Nog was that this is somebody who we have been thinking of as a good character and he loses his shit because he suffers too much. And I think that's what we're seeing with Gator overall, is that it's a good person who loses his shit because he suffered too much, which I liked. I think that, you know... Him going for Kara's man rather than Kara herself aside, this episode is generally well written.
It's a better episode than the previous one, certainly. And
it's still bleak.
And it's not the fault of the episode that it's all feeling a bit too current at the
moment. No. That's just life.
Yeah, yeah.
But then well written science fiction will reflect life.
Yeah, well, this is more like sort of predict, actually, but there we go.
You could say that about Babylon 5 and President Clark.
Well, you could indeed that too as well. Yep.
What did other people think? Did they get as angry as me? We've heard from Sampo and Yonna, who write, one of the main stories is Rosalind basically giving up. She does the grandiose gesture in an empty room by throwing her medicine into the trash. Good and all, but I'm pretty sure someone else could have used that medicine as well.
There is that argument, yeah.
She clearly wants nothing more to do with leading the fleet, and fair enough, but she really should have at least exited more gracefully, if nothing else, publicly retire or something.
I was going to say, she needs to actually exit, yeah. That's the problem.
But she left without explanation, and it leaves a power void that Zarek very quickly starts to fill. It's not that he can offer any solutions, but when you're not in charge, you can just point out the problems. Typical. And you really can't blame the quorum and the civilian fleet for being disgruntled. The total lack of communication from Roslyn and the total lack of cooperation from Adama looks really bad from the outside. It looks pretty bad from the inside as well. And who is the Vice President anyway? Is it Leo Zarek? I'm not even sure. Throughout the episode, we also see that not everyone is as ready to accept the Cylon Alliance as some of our heroes, and it shouldn't really be a surprise.
No.
Neo-genocide is something people don't tend to forget. This is embodied in Gator, who, with the combination of losing his leg and Earth being a bust, is clearly looking for someone to blame. And who better than the foreigners slash immigrants that are the Cylons? It's an age-old story that we see in the real world today. During the episode, Zarek subtly incites a mutiny among the fleet. So Adama has him brought to a cell and manages to bluff him by threatening to air his dirty laundry. It works in the episode, but in a world where Trump exists, it seems a bit naive. Zarek could just say it's all fake news.
Yeah, that would have been unfortunate, yeah.
In the end, we see Gator and Zarek plotting something sinister. The guard is clearly in on it. Funny, in a previous scene, I noticed that the guard looked like a bad guy. Meanwhile, Adama is just lying in the bed with Roslyn, clearly letting his guard down slightly. He's getting his guard down. Something else up, I think.
Yes. It's one word for it.
And apart from all that, a lot more happened as well. I won't dive deep into it, but just to say the cottle smoking was hilarious. I just got really angry. Roslyn doesn't know how to stretch. No, she doesn't. It looked all wrong to me. Tyrell's parenting advice was crap. And also, apparently turning his back on God is interesting.
I don't know. Stay with your kid if they're in hospital seems fairly basic, to be honest. Yeah. There's not much wrong with that.
A jam-packed episode going forward with breakneck speed, and I really disagree with the people who think season 4 is crap. We're totally on board for this.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's crap. I just think it has its weaknesses. Yeah. We've heard from Jeff. This was a much less depressing episode in some ways, but far too relevant in many other ways.
Just a tap.
Arguments about individual rights versus submitting to authorities for the greater good. Violence brewing over changes in political power. The bleakness of a radioactive dead planet feels like welcome escapism in contrast. Alexander Giuliani continues to impress as Felix Gator's awful character journey enters into a new dark phase. It's been fascinating to watch this once bright, energetic, almost naive young officer shaped by awful event after awful event.
Yeah.
His sarcastic, vengeful demeanour is the logical, well-written conclusion to this path. Wish they were able to do this with all the characters. Yes. Some characters just lurch from thing to thing, don't they?
Yeah.
Looking at nobody in particular,
Lee.
Anyway, he continues. I'm not sure why they decided to introduce this strange plot point about Nikki's parentage at this late stage.
It's just so odd, and it does Callie a disservice.
It's introduced because they only want one Cylon baby.
Ugh, first child syndrome.
It did provide me with a bit of happiness in the midst of all the chaos. It was truly heartwarming to see Galen take hot dog under his wig at the end. Wing. No, not his wig.
Hot dog under his wig. He lives with his toupee, and there's a sausage in a bun.
Try and do what's best for Nikki. I'm now hoping for my two dads style sitcom spin-off where straight-laced Tyrell and free spirit hot dog butt heads over the best way to raise Nikki, leading to chuckles along the way and learning a heartwarming lesson at the end of every episode. Don't hold your breath for that, really. I mean, that would have been great, but really don't hold your breath. I hope these episodes haven't brought anybody down too much. Don't suffer alone. Talk to someone you love and trust. We all need all the help we can get in these difficult times. As always, thanks for the excellent podcast and take care. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. What did Andrew make of this?
So this is a bit more normal for Battlestar Galactica. The politicking, the planning, the military hates the civilian government hates the military. Adama versus Zarek, Gator versus Starbuck. Stuff's gonna happen. I honed in a bit on Chief Tyrell as him being someone who, through no fault of his own, as compared with Tori, for instance, who changes sides almost immediately, his ties to Galactica are being cut one by one, to the point now where there's really nothing left that's keeping him on Galactica other than his job. Callie's dead, his child isn't his, so turns out Nicholas is a full human, not a half-human, half-Cylon hybrid. He's been spending time on the base star and is getting confused with them and us and we and you. He doesn't have any meaningful relationships on Galactica anymore. All he has is his work, which isn't even his old work. He's not a chief still. He's just a worker, just clocking in and doing a shift every day. So once again, Galactica has pushed the big red button that's marked civilian government versus military story while President Roslin is on Galactica jogging and throwing away her medicine. Which reminded me of her presidential debate preparation where she has the talking point on a card and then she tears up the card and lets the pieces fall where they may. And then she breaks the pencil, lets the pieces fall where they may. Just the image of pushing all of the medicine off the table and letting them fall where they may. And whatever happens in the future, happens in the future. That image struck me quite strongly. But anyway, back to what I was saying. The Cylons are willing to update the fleet's jump drives, but in exchange they want to be full citizens of the fleet. And Zarek calls a motion in the quorum requiring the captain's permission before any Cylons board the civilian ships. If you need somebody to espouse a view of not giving former enemies a chance at being part of your world, then irony demands that you pick Tom Zarek. But the thing about Tom Zarek that gives the character some dimension is that generally there is some truth to what he says. When he makes this argument about Roslin and Adama, that this whole mission to find Earth has been a cynical attempt by them to keep power and keep control, you know, dangling a carrot in front of the fleet, he's not absolutely wrong. Way back in the miniseries, Adama says to Roslin that the fleet needs something to believe in, let it be Earth. At that point, believing that Earth is completely fictitious, but then there's that self-serving gloss that he gives to that, which is not favourable to Roslin and Adama. And I think it goes back to something I've mentioned before in feedback of Adama as the kingmaker. Adama can afford to be pragmatic in decisions like these because who's going to get rid of him? What does it matter if his subordinates don't like his decisions? They're in the military, they have to follow his orders. Whereas Zarek, being an elected politician, has people to disappoint if he makes the wrong choice. And you notice in the press conference at the beginning, Zarek won't publicly say whether he's for or against an alliance with the Cylons, for fear of offending either side. It's only in private that he makes his feelings clear. Zarek can be voted out where Adama cannot be voted out, so Adama doesn't have to worry about what people think about Cylons coming onto their ships to tinker around with the FTL, where Tom Zarek does have to worry about that. And Zarek's populism and Adama's autocracy find focus in Zarek going to the people's representatives, the quorum, and getting a nearly unanimous agreement from them that the captains of the ships will all have sovereignty, if you will, over those ships, and Cylons won't board those ships without their consent, suborning mutiny in the process, to which Adama responds by authorizing the use of deadly force to arrest Zarek, which in its way only goes to support what Zarek's saying about Adama, you know, do what I say or else. Yet they both want the same thing, really, which is the welfare of the fleet. They want it in different ways, and you want to achieve that welfare through different means. It's the values by which they're defining that welfare. Adama's definition is perhaps more practical, more pragmatic, at least as far as these jump drives are concerned, while Tom Zarek's are more idealistic, more concerned with intangibles, like promising the captains of the fleet that they will have sovereignty over their ships. And I think you know what I mean when I say that word. And also Adama and Roslin have sex, which is, you know, I don't want to say a long time coming, because I know what you're like. Somewhere else on the ship, someone's making a little matchstick man with an erection. Do you imagine Adama sort of tapped the guard outside his quarters on the shoulder and asked him to go and get him a condom? Unless there's one in a desk drawer, but it's been 4 years, those things have a sell-by date. So with the image of Adama and Roslin coiled up in each other's arms and legs like snakes, I'm going to bring this feedback to a close, so thank you for listening, take care, and bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye-bye. All right, bye.
Yeah. A long time coming.
Yeah, thanks for that.
If she's got cancer and she hasn't got long to live, conception isn't a worry.
Yeah.
Also, I'm not being funny, but isn't she old enough to be past the menopause? Maybe she isn't, I don't know.
Hmm. Yeah, don't look at me.
But yeah, you're right that Adama is the kingmaker, but a key part of the problem is he shouldn't be.
Yes.
And there is truth to what Zarek says. I mean, to a large extent, he's not wrong. It's just that he is using it to shit stir, isn't he? He's not morally good in this. He's mostly right, but it's muddied.
Yes,
isn't it?
It is terribly muddy. I mean, he's also clearly crooked as well, which doesn't help. I mean, it's difficult to side with him because you do know that he's got this dodgy past, but he's also not wrong at times.
Yeah. And
which is one thing the series does do right, to be fair, because, you know, usually it's varieties of shades of grey rather
particularly with politicians.
Yes.
Very few of them are actually moral people.
Or the other way to look at it is very few of them are as bad as Trump, basically. That's the way.
Oh, no, that is true.
Yeah.
But I find it difficult to believe, certainly in this country, that most members of Parliament genuinely have the good of the people at heart. I think most of them want their own careers and are acting out of privilege.
Controversial thought there, but anyway.
Sorry. I'm a bit jaded, can you tell?
Yeah, well, that might have something to do with our experience in this particular constituency, which, yes. Anyways, let's find out what Llama God thought.
Okay, so here's an episode that has some solid and interesting stuff going on, and in a way you could potentially see it as a bit of redemption from the previous episode, except that it's not. That's a minor flaw there. This episode highlights why they chose to keep Gator and didn't have him being the angst-driving suicidee from the previous episode. No, he's here because, being the one who's lost hope, he has to form an alliance with Zarek. And yeah, okay, fair enough. That's the storyline they'd written out for him. Why couldn't Dee have done that? There's absolutely nothing to suggest that Dee and Gator couldn't have been replaced in this circumstance. Gator was the one who could have been without hope in the last episode, and Dee could have come to this place of allying with Zarek after seeing close-up and personal exactly how the Adama family has run the fleet, and particularly questionably in some instances. I mean, you just have to look at all that nepotism for starters. Yeah, so Dee could have easily been in this position in a very organic way had the writers actually considered the woman's worthy of being in this position. So, yeah, it's not really helping at all, and it's definitely looking a bit uncomfortable. The only thing you can really say is that Dee was never put on trial by the Circle, so she was never accused of being a traitor. But yeah, that's a minor thing. Good writers could have worked their way around that. So yeah, not looking so great. So as long as they treated other female characters with respect in this episode, we'll be fine. Oh, no, we discover that Callie was sleeping around and that Tyrrell's son isn't actually his son. Wait, that's another one. Once again, we're abusing one of the female cast, and this time in death. This is not a great look. What is this meant to achieve? Are we meant to think that was it okay for Callie to have been killed because, you know, she slept around? Does that make it okay? Is that what this is meant to say? Or is it just because the writers really didn't have any idea of what they were going to do with Tyrrell's baby, and they wanted to focus on the Tigh and Six baby, because that's probably more interesting, so they decided to write it out like this. Is that what they're going for? Because again, that's insensitive and shows a complete lack of forward thinking, and particular unkindness towards Callie's character as well, given that she's down killed off for no reason whatsoever. I mean, maybe that's a point, maybe we're supposed to see hopelessness and pointlessness in the Galactica universe, but again, it does a massive disservice to a character that was a pretty good character, really, along the way. So yeah, I'm not really happy with the writers at this point at all. Which again, is a shame, because there's a lot of good stuff in this episode that's happening with the men. Like, Zarek gets some really great stuff in this episode. He makes a lot of very good points about how the fleet's being run, and it's not like he doesn't have a point a lot of the time, especially with Roslyn going AWOL dealing with her problems. I mean, yeah, she has her problems to deal with, of course, but the fact that she abdicates her role without putting anyone else in charge and leaving it to Zarek really doesn't look particularly well on her. Yeah, okay, so she ends the episode finally sleeping with Adama, and we're meant to feel happy about it, but I really can't remember having trouble doing so. So yeah, with this alliance between Zarek and Gator, it does seem like there's some interesting stuff to come, and there's definitely going to be some turbulent times ahead, but it's really starting to feel uncomfortable now with the way in which the writers seem to be treating a lot of their female characters with contempt. So yeah, we'll see how the final few episodes go, won't we? As to plan watch then, well, it doesn't really seem there's much of a plan from the Silence, does it? They got to Earth ahead of, or not ahead of, but exactly in time with the humans. And, yeah, there we are. Although we do find out that Cylons have happened before, and they are happening again. And that actually the majority of the population of Earth were Cylons. So that certainly opens up some questions, doesn't it? Is humanity descended from Cylons who then created Cylons? Is that a particular example of everything happening before and happening again? Is that what's happening? Because it seems a bit like a reach, but yeah. But at least we know there's still a bit of a civil war going on, because there's Cavill's troops are still out there somewhere. So, yeah. As ever, I'm looking forward to finding out eventually. I'm sorry, I'm caught up with your podcast. Really. Over Christmas, there's been less time than I thought there was going to be. But I am looking forward to hearing what people have made of this, and I'm still looking forward to see what comes in the next episodes, because, yeah, there's a lot of stuff promised, so, yeah. As ever, I hope everyone's keeping safe as we enter Lockdown 3. All of this has happened before, and all of this will happen again, I'm fairly sure. Hopefully one day there is a light at the end of this, a light that may or may not be called Earth, but, yeah, let's hope there's some way out of it. And I'm pretty certain, so say we all.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, of lockdown, all this has happened before and all this will happen again is, Yeah. Yes, absolutely. It is disparaging Callie's character.
Yes, and when you know the reason why they're doing it, which is purely because they want, and it's not even Tigh and Six's baby, but they want Hera to be the only Cylon baby around. Yeah, it's not good, is it?
No, it's not at all. And as I said before, you know, her arc was all about she marries her abuser. So if there was somebody else available, it muddies the waters unnecessarily, and it's just bollocky writing. And you've got the whole thing, absolutely, where they could have swapped Gator and Dee, and they could have had Gator go and Dee be the one who's partnering in an uprising, because she's seen what nepotism does. She's seen the damage the Adama administration does. You know, why did she leave?
Yeah.
You could have linked it in with that.
Possibly. I mean, it would have been a bit more of a stretch for her just because she hasn't lost a limb. that's possibly the big difference between the two of them.
But again, they did fuck all with her. If they'd written her properly and thought about it and planned it, they could have had something happen to her. Not necessarily
I'm not sure I would have seen that character rebelling against Lee and his father. But that's not a reason for killing her off. There's a million other things they could have done with the character. I think the fact that Felix has lost his leg gives him the most obvious reason to be the person on the inside that Sarek then allies up with. But yes, that's not an excuse for killing her off.
No.
Or not finding anything better to do with her character.
No, it isn't. And again, the misogynistic writing continues where...
It feels that way, doesn't
where,
it?
Where yes, Gator isn't...
Which I just... How ironic is this, considering how well the series started in terms of the way it treated women characters?
Yeah.
It just, as a result, judging it, you know, accordingly, it has fallen a long way, hasn't
it? A really long way. And, you know, and it's all part of that, that there is Gator, who could be confronting Kara over her own failings as captain.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Which are fucking many. Fucking painting with poo and all that shit, literally.
Yeah.
And what he confronts her over is her man.
Yeah. I agree with why you're pissed off about that. That's understandable.
And I can't feel happy about Roslyn and Adama either in the circumstances. It feels reckless and selfish, when actually what you want is for it to feel loving and nice.
Yes, and you want to feel sympathetic considering what she's going through, but at the same time you're aware of...
She has to step down, so
exactly.
She can't.
And it wouldn't be difficult for her to do. I don't quite understand why she didn't do it. There doesn't seem to be a reason for it, beyond the fact that Adama can't accept Zarek, which is just like completely the wrong reason.
Yes.
Hey-hos.
Sorry. Can you tell we've... been angry.
I wonder why.
Now, what I want to know is Tracy angry? Or Drew?
Hello, this is a feedback for A Disquiet Follows My Soul.
And what do we think of that one then?
Yeah.
There was a lot going on in this.
Yeah. Exactly. Chief has gone full on Cylon, hasn't he? It was like done a bit comedic, but he's like full on.
We want citizenship,
us
and we want
and
to do
you,
this, and these are our terms. And if you don't abide by them, or if you don't give us like citizenship, then we're not going to like comply with you. That was a bit intense.
It was, but I was just more thinking about he's now talking about us.
Yeah, exactly.
He,
yeah,
know?
He's kind of flip reversed it, isn't he?
And when this stuff about Nikki came out, which I must admit, totally blindsided me. I had not remembered that he wasn't the father. And we thought at first he'd dropped Nikki. We was like, oh, that's some cold Cylon moves.
Well, that is how they kind of portrayed it. Because
they did,
when he was in the hospital and the doc was kind of taking him through the, oh, you know, patient confidentiality and all that, like, I said to you, he's not the father.
I know, I was like, oh.
And then he was like, you know, look after him. We were like, you bastard. That didn't take you long to turn your back on him.
No, but it wasn't, though, was it? Because by the end, and he got old hot dog in.
That's true.
And
he
was like, no, we're going to both sort this out.
But let's just go back to the beginning when they were in the hospital. So Tigh and Six are having their scan on the baby, and she's going on about how this is the first time we've had a Cylon to Cylon conception.
Baby,
yeah. And how it's going to be...
the saviour.
Yeah, so what is so special about Tigh then? Because obviously she said that they have tried for quite a long time to
do
Cylon
to
Cylon conception. So what is so special? Has he got like super sperm or something?
He might have super sperm, yeah.
He might have.
I don't know. They did, there was this stuff about only a baby conceived of love, they said before, where they said about Hilo and Sharon.
Well, this
maybe
is
it's
Athena,
out, I don't know.
Because
who knows?
Athena...
Because I guess they did conceive the baby while before Saul knew he was a Cylon, I think.
Do you reckon
maybe?
It was... Well...
I don't know.
I was going to say, do you reckon it was through love? But he was seeing Ellen...
Yeah,
when
I know.
He was having it off. So
I don't think we're ever going to be having an answer to any of this.
But just the Cylons have obviously had babies before because I had written down, obviously, Athena and Hilo had had
Hera.
Yeah,
but that's not a Cylon baby.
No, I'm not. I'm not saying that. But it's not like Cylons can't conceive.
No, but only in special circumstances.
So what makes it so special that it's a Cylon to Cylon? Because I guess
know.
It's like, a, in the words of Harry Potter, a pure blood.
I guess so.
Maybe. So they create a rule.
Yep.
Or Tom Zarek puts a motion forward that only
yeah.
Cylons can board the ships if they get permission.
By the
which,
captain.
To be fair, is not a bad rule. They are still Cylons at the end of the day. So why is Lee against it?
I know. I don't know whether this is all painted out that we should be on like Adama's side. I'm not. I just feel like the people are voting for the people to represent them and they're making these rules up and then Adama's just going, oh no, it's a military decision, we're going to overrule you.
But it's a military decision because it just turns out that his best mate, i.e. his second in command, has turned out to be a Cylon. Not long ago, he wanted to kill the fuckers.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, he's now being a Cylon sympathiser.
I just feel like, I just always think about trumping about reality. Like if the military was saying... Oh, you might have, all your politicians voted in these rules, but we're going to take over because it's a military decision and overrule them. Like, the whole country would be like, what the hell's going on?
It's not reality, darling.
I know it's not reality,
but
I'm just saying, that is how I feel. It's like, I think they're in the wrong, aren't they?
And what the fuck is Gator doing?
Oh, Gator's descent, isn't
it?
But again, though, I feel that he's acting like he's always been a moral person.
Yeah.
And I've said before, he's a character I really like.
Yeah.
He's doing what he feels is right.
Yeah.
He sees this stuff that's going on behind the scenes. He's behind the curtain and he's acting on it.
But what he said to Starbuck in the mess hall,
that wasn't
good, fucking spot on, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, but...
That was spot on. You know, she was going to fly him out of her bloody...
Definitely.
...thingy. Anywho.
Yeah, and it ends up with Adama is literally in bed with the president. That is a thing there, isn't it? They're showing that the military in bed with the president.
Yeah.
But yeah, good episode,
yeah,
I thought.
Yeah, it was all right. Quite
it's
a lot
good.
Going on.
Good stuff going
on. We liked Boltar's haircut, didn't we?
We do like he's had his short haircut, yeah.
Anyway, leave it there.
Okay.
Let's have the next one.
Yep.
See you later.
Bye. Yeah, I mean, that whole thing about the miracle baby with Tigh and Six is because these are two Cylons propagating the species together, which they've not been capable of before. So that's why it's so game-changing, I think the phrase is.
Yeah, but they can't... You're right to call back to the whole only a baby conceived of love, but is it really love, given that he was seeing Ellen?
Well, he loves Ellen, so yeah, but...
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Unless it's so all wrong. Connected to the Cylon's ability to project.
Yeah.
And Ellen, you know, the sex bot, is the source of Six.
Oh, right. Okay.
In other words, he's seeing a connection that is there.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, I mean, in terms of Hoobly, Tyrell. Him being right into being a Cylon now. Well, as Andrew said in his feedback, his ties to Galactica have been broken one by one.
Mm. And interesting, Ron Moore was saying that originally the plan was for him, basically, once he'd gone down to Earth, he was then going to return to the base star.
Yeah.
And become one of the Cylons, basically. And then they thought, oh no, there's more to be mined from the fact that if he's still on Galactica.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
But he doesn't fit anymore on Galactica, quite clearly. So.
No, it's just a shame they had to damage Callie's reputation to break another of his ties to Galactica. There could have been another way of doing it. And in terms of the consistency of military decisions, they're not consistent. It does seem to be Adama's whim. And the idea of the military just going, you know what, yeah, we've just decided this is the military decision. Well, in most countries, that would be a coup.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that it would in all. I think it would depend on the constitution, but from what we know of the constitution of Galactica, it would be a coup. And yeah, it is literally the military in bed with the presidency, isn't it?
Yes, it is, ironically, yeah. Which shouldn't be a happy ending, but it is kind of presented as it is.
It is, which is not good. I didn't like Baltar's haircut. What did Parry make of this?
Hello again, Parry here to talk about A Disquiet Follows My Soul. This one is one of these kind of... It's not a bad episode, but it is a bit mechanical. I don't mean that in a bad way. What we're doing is we're setting up things that are about to happen, so pieces are being moved into place. Our main action, much as it is actually to do with the Tellium ship running away and then being recaptured, but that's actually because Tom Zarek is stirring up the Quorum, and that's because one of the things that they're proposing is an alliance with the Cylons. They're wanting representation on the Quorum and protection of the fleet, and in return they're going to share some good Cylon technology. I did like the scene with Tyrell kind of getting confused, you're saying, oh yes, our technology is better than ours, theirs, and Ty just going, I can draw you a chart. I thought that was quite fun. And yeah, you know, there's obviously, I think Zarek's now very much realising that he's there mainly because Adama tolerates it and he's not happy, and so he's wanting to change things around. I mean, oddly enough, he is about the only democratically elected one there. But yeah, trouble's stirring. You can see Gaeta as well, he's not happy. And he's also stirring up trouble. And we do get, there's kind of an odd, you get, I mean, I did like Tigh looking at the ultrasound as well, because I don't know how much trouble did you guys having making out particularly the early ultrasounds. It's kind of, I still swear at times the doctor just put on a video and, you know, it's like, ah, that's totally your baby. And I'm like, is it though? I mean, you know, I still shared the picture. They were saying, that's definitely a baby, and people are going, aye, sure, Murray. But yeah, you've got that. You've also got Tyrell finding out, and that's actually interesting because we were thinking there are two part Cylon children. And of course, we find out that Tyrell's isn't, because as it turns out, Callie had a fling with Hot Dog. Insert your bad euphemisms or puns with his pilot codename here. Yeah, and I quite like, you know, being a father, it sucks, you stay here while I sober up. And I do like the fact that I don't think he's going to drop out the kid's life, but rather that, you know, essentially now that kid's going to have two dads. That's nice. He's got my two dads thing going along. One's that co-pilot that hangs around everywhere, and the other one's a half a Cylon deck chief, so that's a thing. But obviously this is gearing up. We're getting some disquiet in the fleet, and it doesn't help that at the moment Rosalind has checked out. She's effectively given up. She's you know, in a state of euphoria because the toxins of the cancer drugs are wearing off, and she's now you know, avoiding. I think she's just wanting to chill out. Although, you know, her and Adama finally get it on, so that's nice. The other thing, Cottle, have you noticed Cottle's getting a lot grumpier? I did like it. He was on top form, particularly the ticing. I could use a drink. He's like, oh, have a cigarette instead. And that, I can't remember her name, but the assistant going, you know, maybe you shouldn't be smoking around the pregnant lady. He's like, yeah. As always, Cottle is worth good mileage whenever he's on screen. So yeah, I think some interesting stuff coming up, and we're going to. I mean, it's definitely not cheery viewing on a dark January evening, but we're where we are. So all that remains me to say is, do keep up the good work. I always look forward to the podcast, and I hope to feedback on the next few. But until then, bye for now.
Bye.
Yes,
good point about ultrasounds. Our first one was a bean, wasn't
yeah,
it? Literally, it looked like a bean. It's like, that's a child, is it? Okay.
That's true. Yeah. And I also enjoyed Tyrell's confusion and Ty's offer of a chart. That was good fun. And what was Hot Dog doing with his sausage?
Well, let's not go. But it is very much a setting up episode. You're right, Parry. Yeah.
Yeah. And Cottle does seem to be getting grumpier. Although, what was he? We saw him in recently, and he wasn't as grumpy.
Oh, he didn't have a speaking role, but he's in Tron Legacy as the grandparent of the main character.
Yeah.
It's Cottle!
We did expect him to be smoking, didn't we?
Yeah, we did rather, but there we are. Well, thank you to everybody who's fed back.
Thank you.
And to everybody who's made it through the grimness.
Oh.
Can I get any grimmer? I hope not. But next time, recording on Thursday, 21st of January, we'll be looking at The Oath and Blood on the Scales.
Blood on the Scales.
That's Blood on the Quad. Yeah, not even I know. Close.
What, three words out of four?
That does not count.
Anyway, I think we've had that, haven't we?
Possibly. Anyway, for a more upbeat podcast, we begin our coverage on Lower Decks, recording on the 30th of January over on the Borgcast feed. So if you're in the mood for lighter stuff, I suspect that might be the place to go. So say we all.
So say we all. The music at the beginning of this podcast was arranged and performed by Drew Barker.
All other music is used for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
The artwork for Borgcast Galactica was created by Andy Palastides.
To contact us, send emails or mp3s to borgcast@gmail.com.
Contact us via Twitter at rev_org or borgcastammo, hashtag Borgcast.
Visit our website at galactica.libsyn.com
or view images relating to our cast on our Tumblr site, borgcast.tumblr.com.
You can join our Facebook page. There's also a Spotify playlist with all our playout tunes on it.
Shut it down!
By your command.
They're all cunts!